The Orange Bowl, Miami, Florida, home to the nation's number one team, the Miami Hurricanes. You know, the Orange Bowl could be a particularly tough place to play, even if it's not Halloween evening. And tonight, the University of Miami goes for its 50th consecutive home victory as they play host to the Mountaineers of West Virginia. When you come to the Orange Bowl to play, you take on some very tough odds. But in 1992, it has been the Miami Hurricanes who have faced adversity.
It was terrifying for some and fatal for a few when Andrew roared across the Florida Peninsula just south of Miami.
This team has been through a lot of adversity, and the more adversity you have, the stronger you become.
Through it all, they battled and won, beating rival Florida State at home, surviving against Penn State up north. So they sit atop the rankings 7-0.
I think it's just things that bring us together as a team and make us better as a team because it puts us all together as one.
The more we go through, the closer we get. We cannot lose. We will not lose. We have to dominate.
We're in the visitors' locker room here at the Orange Bowl, where 49 straight football teams have returned to this locker room with a loss after playing the Miami Hurricanes. Tonight's opponent, the West Virginia Mountaineers. And they come into the stadium tonight confident. A few of their players even predicted a win over the Hurricanes. For West Virginia to win this football game, they must establish their running game with their tailback, Adrian Morrell, both inside and outside, which will open up quarterback Darren Studstill in the play-action game. He replaces the injured Jake Kelchner tonight. When you attack the Miami defense, they're strong up front, very quick in the secondary, but the key to the Miami defense, the linebackers, they're very tough. You have to neutralize them. Michael Barrell, Jesse Armstead, and Darren Smith.
That defense has helped the Hurricanes win 25 straight. But you know something? Undefeated streaks being named number one, not enough anymore. Now the team of the 80s wants to be known as the team of all time. Look at the legend. Throughout the course of college football, no team, not Notre Dame, not Oklahoma, not even Bears Alabama, won five titles in 10 years' time. Rusty Medeiros, you played on two of those national title teams. Put this in perspective for us.
Well, I think you can put us on the top of that mighty list right there, because we've done it with the pressure of voters, of the media, and a worldwide audience. And you can tell it in college football because everybody wants to try to imitate the Hurricanes. But there's one thing that won't change. Nobody plays with more
presentation of college football is being brought to you by Thrifty Car Rental. For worldwide reservations, call 1-800-4-CARS. By Olympus, never miss another O. And by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil, add more life to your car. Aerial view on a beautiful game, the Orange Bowl in Miami, Florida. And tonight's combatants, West Virginia, in town to take on the Miami Hurricanes. Don Neyland, 13th season at West Virginia, 90 wins, 53 losses, and 4 ties. And, of course, Dennis Erickson, 40-3. Had an unbelievable record since he's been here, 93% the winning percentage. 50 straight. That's what the Hurricanes try to make it here tonight. Miami won the toss. They deferred to the second half. Dane Pruitt will kick it off as some of the Miami faithful standing and awaiting the kickoff. Garrett Ford, one of the two escape men. Joining him, number 6, Damian Gallimore on the other side. 23.9 his average, the longest 45. We're underway. Two. Puts the head down and he's out to the 27-yard line. And our Energizer starting lineups. First of all, for the Mountaineers of West Virginia, Darren Studstill gets the start because Kelchner is injured. The wide receivers, James Jett, Olympic speed, but he's also a football player as well. And at the offensive front, the center may be as good an offensive lineman as they have ever had at West Virginia. Big Mike Compton at 6'7", 289. He is a Lombardi finalist. first down, has 5 yards, and he slides for 7. And now let's meet the starters on defense for the Miami Hurricanes. A 4-3, Darren Frein, the left defensive end. Oh, what a job he has done this year, particularly in the absence of Medeiros. The linebackers may be as good as any in the country. The most underrated is Darren Smith. And in the secondary, watch for number 47, Ryan McNeil. Scouts say he probably will be the first cornerback taken in next year's draft. Nelson, he got tangled up with his feet and he went down, and it now will be a third down for the Mountaineers, and they lose yardage on the play.
Ron, one of the problems for the Miami defensive coaches, the fact that Darren Studstill is starting quarterback tonight. Jake Kelchner is injured. Jake Kelchner is a drop back quarterback. Darren Studstill more of an option guy, so you can't blitz him as much.
The numbers that will be missing tonight: Jake with an elbow injury, they had to cut on it yesterday. Pressure from the outside, swings it out of the backfield. That's Freeman up the sideline, and he'll have the first down, plus 4 more out to the 42-yard line. Greer pushes him out.
One thing that Miami likes to do on defense, they like to set the tone of the game right away. So on third down, they did bring a blitz. West Virginia picked it up. Darren Studstill with a nice throw to Jim Freeman out of the backfield, number 29.
Tight end goes out of the ball game, John Caput, and West Virginia will go with 3 wide receivers, 2 to the top of your screen. Play action. Under pressure, he's going to be sacked, and that's Mark Caesar, the senior out of Newark.
When you play Miami, you have to be ready for the 4-3 defense and 2 deep coverage. But if you notice right here, tonight against this particular formation where West Virginia has 3 wide receivers, Miami's in a 3 deep secondary. Then the pressure comes from Mark Caesar, number 99. So they changed a little bit of their defensive philosophy tonight against West Virginia.
Second down with the loss, we'll call it 15. Look at number 91, Darren Frein, the junior from Aurora, Colorado. Corral, and he loses his footing again. Mike, that's a couple of times that he has tried to make the quick cut and has just gone down. He's going to lose yardage again.
We talked about the fact that Miami had to make some adjustments. Usually when you prepare your game plan, you play it for the first plan and for the first team quarterback. And they planned a lot of different adjustments for Jake Kelchner. They had to scratch them for Darren Studstill tonight, so they were making adjustments the day at the hotel on changes to be made.
Studstill, 6'2", 185, and a junior out of Riviera Beach, Florida. Pressure again from the outside. Gets it over the middle. Has a man open. Oh, my goodness. He should have popped the football right through the hands of Adrian Morrell at the 39-yard line. Harris was there with the cover, but he should have caught this one.
On this play, Ron, West Virginia threw in the 2 deep coverage. They had the right route on the corner route. You see him open, but the longer that ball's in the air, the longer it gives Miami defensive backs a chance to break on the football.
Kevin Williams. Some people have tried to kick away from him because he is so dangerous. This is a handy punt. Williams from the 14. Gets to the 30. 49 yards in the kick and 16 on the return. And let's meet the starters for the Hurricanes on offense tonight. Gino Toretta. Well, is he the number 3 candidate in the Heisman race? He can move forward again this evening. The wide receivers, just an exceptional group. But Lamar Thomas is the big play guy. And he's out of Gainesville, Florida. Now, the offensive front, the line really came together when this guy came back. Number 72, Mario Cristobal, as he returned against Florida State from an injury. Setback, pass is thrown, and it's Williams out of the backfield close to the 40, and Kevin will be wrestled out of bounds at about the 39.
You see it in Kevin Williams.
Now the defensive starters, the best pass rusher of that down 4 is Tom Briggs out of Liverpool, New York. Now the linebackers, Puppy Wright did a lot of talking this week, and we're going to find out if Puppy is the big dog or not. And in the secondary,
Well, it's a very good group, but Kwame Smith, the veteran out of right here in Miami, will have his hands full tonight with this receiving core. Running play for three, now four by Bennett.
Ron, I was starting to say about Kevin Williams that he's healthy tonight, probably for the first time this year. He got hurt against Iowa, hurt his ankle, but he is 100% tonight, so look for him to be more involved in the offense tonight. He's just a big play receiver. He's a big play punt returner.
Kevin, a junior out of Dallas, Texas. He has had injury problems with a knee and also with an ankle. A junior, 5'9", 185. Gino wants a timeout. Comes right out from under center, so we'll take it with him. 11:29 left to play, opening quarter. Canes and West Virginia, no score. ESPN's presentation of college football is being brought to you by Oldsmobile, the power of intelligent engineering. And by Bud Light. If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down, make it a Bud Light. Now that's a great shot of the Orange Bowl here in Miami. Not quite full tonight, but for the most part, the Miami Rooters are here. Just a few empty corners up in the upper reaches. On first down, they go with a reverse, now double reverse. Williams gives it to Thomas, gets outside, and will finally be stopped just across midfield by Kwame Smith, the senior from here in Miami.
Miami's trying to slow down the pursuit of West Virginia here in the first series with the double reverse. Kevin Williams, the first man, then hands off to Lamar Thomas. Picks up some nice blocking. Kwame Smith, number 23, makes the tackle.
Mike, he wasn't the only one, but did you see number 13 peeling back there to block after the second handoff? Gino was back there blocking for his guy. That's a gain of 8. Complete. Darryl Spencer breaks away inside the 30-yard line to the 29. Leroy Exum finally put a stopper on him, but it's a gain of 16.
Ron, when you have a veteran quarterback like Gino Toretta, you better disguise your blitzes. Now West Virginia tipped off the blitz. Gino Toretta read it very easily, moved his back up, threw the quick out, big yardage.
Miami quickly back to the line of scrimmage. West Virginia had the opening series. They had to punt it away, and the first time that we've seen the Canes tonight on offense. Puts it on a hit. Oh, wide open on the near sideline at the 20-yard line. 17, Coleman Bell, the senior from Tampa, who lines up at tight end. 6'2", 225. They just slid him out away from the trip set to the top of the screen. Mike, what about this young man? He gets started getting more attention the last couple of weeks. A lot of people say he's number three right now.
Well, I don't think so. I think he comes into tonight's game after what happened today, number one.
Well, he's got a shot at moving up. I don't think there's any question about that. Senior out of Noel, California. We'll go with the running play. 2, 3, 4 yards for Donnell Bennett. I'm going to mark him down at around the 16-yard line. I got to do something before we go any further. I promised Toretta that his family has an establishment in Pinole called Antlers Tavern, and they're having a special barbecue tonight. And he said, make sure that we say hey to the home folks back in Pinole. So
might earn you a free meal out there when you get out there.
Next time I go to Pinole, yeah. Hello to Antlers. Short drop this time. Quick out. Thomas again at the 10-yard line. Going to be hit and pushed back. Again, it's Kwame Smith who draws the coverage, and that's a tough assignment on Thomas.
Well, it is a tough assignment, but what you can't measure in a quarterback, you see statistics all the time, but you can't measure decisions. Now, this drive, he is picking apart the West Virginia defense. He reads it when it's a blitz. He throws the quick pass. He reads when they're playing pass coverage. He runs the football. He is just really outsmarting the West Virginia defense at this point.
Again, three wide receivers, this time to the bottom of your screen. inside the five. Wes Richardson, a junior out of Bethel Park, Pennsylvania, puts the stopper on it.
Ron, one thing when you play Miami, yeah, you've got to gear it up. But you can also do too many things and add fuel, like when the players were quoted. And I like that sometimes. I don't like to hold players back. But I tell you, when you fuel these guys up, they come out to play.
Well, Puffy Wright, number four, is the man who did a lot of talking, saying that Miami couldn't score more than 17 points against this Mountaineer defense. Brown and Richardson stepping up to make the hit. Bennett goes into the pile.
Always liked that when you talk about somebody make a statement. I always liked it when my big defensive tackle, about 6'6", 250, makes that statement, we're going to win and stop you. I kind of follow him. Linebackers, I'm not sure.
And you'd never let a defensive back talk then, huh?
I'll tell you what, it's in our kids. I mean, they just, Puffy Wright's into this game. He's from Miami, so it means a lot to him.
Good look there at number 30, David Mayfield. 10th play of this drive for the Hurricanes. Where the pass was caught.
Ron, he even interfered with him, and he still made the catch.
Pass interference on the defense. Touchdown.
Gino Toretta lays this fade pass perfect to Lamar Thomas. You see him grab the football. Pass interference on Kwame Smith, but they'll take the score.
Dane Pruitt tries to put the Hurricanes on top, 7-0. The touchdown, 7:59 left to play in this opening quarter. Dennis Erickson likes what he sees so far. Offensive line of the Hurricanes, Etheridge, London, Green, Vickers, and Cristobal. What a job they did in that opening drive for Miami tonight. And they go on top with a very convincing opening drive, 7-0, with only 7:59 left in this opening quarter. Garrett Ford, one of the two deep men for West Virginia. For that, we should explain, because of the penalty on the touchdown in the end zone, and that's the reason that he moved it up 15 yards forward.
Gino Toretta just takes one drop step. Now he's throwing for the corner of the end zone. He's throwing for a spot. Lamar Thomas just gets in front of the receiver, uses his body, and makes the catch on the fade route.
Here's a scoring drive and a couple of impressive things. 10 plays, 70 yards, 403. No third downs in the entire drive. And listen to this, 5 of 5 for Toretta. As you look at Kwame Smith, 5 of 5, 46 yards, and one touchdown for Toretta on that drive. That is near perfect. In fact, I guess it is perfect, isn't it? Adrian Morrell with the carry, spins off a couple.
Adrian Morrell carries.
What Miami's going to do on defense with Adrian Morrell is take their defensive ends, Kevin Patrick and Darren Krein, and bring them down inside and force Adrian Morrell to bounce to the linebackers and let the linebackers make the play.
Could see number 45 come into the picture, and Morrell just had no place to go.
Well, it's a great run by Adrian Morrell, because he should lose 10 yards on this play. It's an option into the short side of the field, and the linebackers are in great shape. Darren Smith's in good shape. Here comes Michael Barrow, but then Adrian Morrell reverses his field and makes yardage on a play that should have been a loss for 10 yards.
You're right.
He's running for his life, though.
That's right. So it's third down. Jones comes into the lineup along with Jim Freeman in the secondary for the Mountaineers. Safety valve pass goes to to Hill, and he will have the first down, plus about 10 out to the 40. Michael Barrow put the stop on it.
Well, that's a key play of Adrian Morrell, because now you were faced with a long yardage situation instead of just a couple yards for the first down. You have to avoid negative yardage against Miami because they're so active. You have to always try to get your 3-4 yards against them and keep the chains moving.
12 yards, first and 10.
7-0 if you have just joined us. We're just under the midway point of this opening quarter. Miami on top. From behind, gets away, but he will not get away from Mark Caesar, who also comes in to make the hit. And Kevin Patrick, number 86. It was Mark who hit him first.
Ron, I've always felt the strength of the Miami team is their front four, the Cortez Kennedys, the Jerome Browns, the great players that have played here. Mark Caesar, number 99. Kevin Patrick, number 86. Pressured Darren Studstone, taking him to the ground.
And Big Mike Compton, the All-American center for West Virginia, with a bit of a scare on that one, as you could see the defensive player come rolling up the back of his leg, but Compton is okay. Morrell runs into his own man. Check it. John Jones runs into his own man. Stretch it outside, and Darren Smith was right there to make the tackle. Also, Casey Greer comes from that strong safety position.
See, put yourself in the offensive coordinator's shoes tonight. You can't afford negative yardage plays. Now, that's two plays in a row that went backwards against the Miami defense. Don Nayland's team has to be the aggressor and keep the Miami defense off balance. You got to throw when they think you're going to run, run when they think you're going to throw. And even then, I'm not sure. This great defensive football team.
Well, to show you how much confidence they have in the backups, Kenny Lopez and Warren Sapp have come in the reserves in defensive tackle. Morrell going to be hit and knocked down for negative yardage again. And guess who? Darren Smith. The other two get so much credit, Michael Barrow and Jesse Armstead, but Smith is the one.
Tom Tuberville, the linebacker coach for the University of Miami, told me that Darren Smith has everything you'd want in a football player linebacker. Size, speed, watch him come in, make the tackle on Adrian Morrell. Effort is there, maybe the best linebacker they've ever had, Tommy Tuberville feels.
Second punt of the night by West Virginia. Williams, the deep man, this time for the 23. And to the 30. Very good open field tackle. That's 48 yards in the punt and 7 on the return. Robert Walker makes the stop. Well, be sure to join Mike, Adrian, and myself next Saturday night for a huge one from the Big 8 Conference. It's the 18th-ranked Kansas Jayhawks traveling to Lincoln, Nebraska to take on the Cornhuskers, who had a huge win today at a game that could decide the league championship. Next Saturday, 7:30, right here on ESPN. Boy, did the Huskers ever have a big one today. The kids got tired of hearing they couldn't win a big one, Mike. They've poured it on a good Colorado team.
Solid win for Tom Osborne.
Larry Jones right up the middle. 10, 15, 20. We got a track meet. Breaks off another tackle, and he will score from 70 yards out. Like that, Larry Jones, not a starter, comes in, knocks it for 70, and all of a sudden the Canes on top, 13-0. Pruitt knocks it home, and with 4:17 left in this opening quarter, like lightning, the Hurricanes have become a very spooky early on. Right on the sideline, and he had a hand on the ball carrier, but that's about all he got on it. I'll show you in just a moment. Flag is down as Miami is off in the kickoff. Offside. Gallimore, and oh, does he get ripped. Ball is loose. Robert Bass is the man who made the hit.
Offsides on the kicking team.
And it was very clear when it happened, and it happened right in front of Dennis. There's the offside right there. Bottom of your screen at the 35-yard line. Ball is not yet kicked. There it is. So the Hurricanes already up 14 to nothing. And that man knows that they had an opportunity to just blow it wide open with the fumble that they had recovered inside the 15-yard line.
His big concern right now is he keeps the fire lit. You know, sometimes you can score so fast and rapidly that you lose concentration.
And Don Nealon knows that it is an absolute must that his football team get something going rapidly. This is Gallimore. Well, gets by him, actually. And Ford will go down on one knee. From the 20.
Key block on the last touchdown to be by Terrell Green on the linebacker number 41. The Springs Larry Jones for the big score. Wes Richardson, number 41, the linebacker, is blocked out of view. Now Larry Jones busts a couple tackles. Now here's real speed. He's off to the races. The Breeders' Cup.
You could see number four. Puppy Wright, one of those who had a shot at him, couldn't get him. Burrell going to be hit and knocked down at the line of scrimmage. It's Warren Sapp, defensively, number 76, a freshman from Apopka, Florida.
Mike Jacobs, the offensive coordinator for West Virginia, will try to counter the speed of Miami with the tailback counter plays, boots and waggles with Darren Studstill. Misdirection plays to try to help counter that speed on defense.
Miami already close to 100 yards rushing following that 70-yard scamper in West Virginia. Negative yardage so far. That's still no place to run. Throws it almost intercepted by Fry. Tim Brando, what do you have for us?
I've got Southern Cal taking on Arizona State. And watch this 30-yard pass from Rob Johnson to Curtis Conway. Arizona State is 4-3, needs a win to stay in the bowl hunt, Ron.
Okay, so the Trojans up on top. By the way, that was Rusty Medeiros on the sideline. You probably recognized him. The crime came close to duplicating what he did at Penn State.
Certainly did. It was very close to the interception.
Third down, line to make the 30. There to him, and also 45, Darren Smith. And again, West Virginia will have to punt it away.
Michael Barrow, number 56, one of the best students of the game, his coach has told us. Watches film all the time. His brother played for the University of Akron, Carlos Barrow.
Todd Sauerbrunn to kick again, his third kick of the night. He has done an outstanding job. Williams, let's bounce. Flag comes in across the way, and Kevin will be denied the 35.
Ron, there's a holding at the line of scrimmage on Miami. That's the first penalty.
Well, we got a flag at the 23, one at the 33, and then across midfield at the 36-yard line.
First one was a hold on the interior line of Miami.
Holding on the receiving team. Offsides on the receiving team.
Buddy Ward, our referee tonight. and Adrian Karsten. Let's get a report from you.
Ron, the pressure's really going to be on the Mountaineer defensive line now. Coming from Coach Karlavich, he says, look, no matter how far Gino Toretto's dropping back, you've got to use your swim and your rip technique. Here's what I mean. If you would, like a swimming motion, you take your offensive lineman, push him right through, or a rip technique, come up underneath his arm and get right back to the quarterback. Toretto's got too much time.
Hey, walk on down to that offensive line in Miami and do that swim technique, see where you land.
Adrian, I thought it was a good example. However, I will say, after looking at the tie, you dressed in that closet where the light bulb was burned out again, didn't you?
Offside, on the receiving team, he cried. Only on the receiving team will be a post-scrimmage enforcement, 10 yards, first down.
There's a lot of teams that would like to dress Adrian Karsten out, the size that he has.
Sometimes it might be hard to pick up, but Adrian's like 6'6", 270, somewhere in that vicinity. That's before his nightly meal. So the penalty's going to push it back to the 20-yard line. We have 2:37 left in the opening quarter, and it has been all Miami. West Virginia still looking for anything that might grab a little momentum in this football game. So far, they have not been able to come close to containing the Miami offense.
They need to force a turnover. They need to make a stop here on this drive to try to get this momentum switched.
Now, Gino, as we mentioned on that opening drive, was absolutely perfect. And he didn't have to do anything on the last one but hand it off, and he got a 70-yard touchdown run. Copeland and pushed out of bounds. And Mike, you might talk about what the shotgun has done for Miami. It really has solved some problems, hasn't it?
It's helped them because their offensive line is inexperienced, and Gino Toretto's been hit a lot in the last few ball games. So they went to the shotgun. It's added about 120 yards, they feel, the coaches, onto their offense in a ball game because it gives them a better view.
He told me yesterday, just after practice, that because of being standing back there, you got so much better vision of the blitz that is coming, or anybody who's gotten off a blocker. Jones this time will be stopped after a gain of a couple, and now it's going to be a third down. Rick Dolly defensively for the Mountaineers.
Third down.
Just to go back to the shotgun run, you talk about a better view, but you take less hits back there also on the shotgun because their passing game is a quick passing game. He could dump the ball off quick on the three-step routes, the five-step routes.
And because of the speed of the Miami wide receivers, the short routes are normally there because you just want to make sure they don't run a stop and then up on you. That's what I'm talking about right there. Lamar Thomas has the first down. Tommy Oyer is there to make the hit.
They've been so successful with the shotgun, if they go back to it, look for him to screen or try to run the ball off him to off the shotgun to try to establish that as an entire offense for themselves. Gino Toretto is making a statement.
I think he's trying to move out of that Ross Perot position, huh?
Well, I'm not so sure about that. I think Ross is doing all right, too.
And he's projected as the number three candidate right now. Gino steps up, drills the ball, and what a catch close to the first down by Lamar Thomas. Now they're going to say he did not catch the ball, that he secured it off the ground. I think the replay will bear this out.
The shot going to give Gino Toretto the chance to move around. Here's the pass, and a great call by the official.
Yeah, good call. Well, here are his records. Entering tonight, 850 attempts. See the passing yardage, almost 6,500. We saw this youngster in his first start against Florida State back when. Jones is going to be collared, and now more than collared, maybe face mask. As the markers come down, Steve Perkins along with Tim Brown making the hit for West Virginia.
Face mask on the defense.
Ron, I think it was 1982. I played Miami here when I was at the University of Cincinnati. I was talking to Howard Snellenberg before the game. Jim Kelly was his starting quarterback. He was hurt. He had two big, tall, gangly freshmen over there warming up. Vinny Testaverde, Bernie Kosar. So he had a wealth of quarterbacks back then, and that is just duplicated because in recruiting, quarterbacks want to come to the University of Miami.
Boy, that goes without saying. By the way, some great blimp shots there. The Goodyear Stars and Stripes out of Pompano Beach, Florida. With us tonight at the controls, Captain Jim Maloney from Vienna, Virginia. Play action, puts it right on the numbers of Coleman Bell, gets the block, and he's off to the races, pushed out of bounds at the 39 by Mike Collins.
The pass is complete to Coleman Bell.
24 yards.
The play game.
Coleman Bell, the tight end, has to become a little bit of an actor here because he's going to block, and then he's going to shoot out in the flat. Gino Toretta's going to fake and roll this way to counter the run action. Coleman Bell slips out in the flat. Now he picks up a block by number 35, Daryl Spencer, for more yardage.
Draw play as Bennett is back in the lineup. A shoulder-high stab at the 35.
Donnell Bennett.
Even though the Canes are on top 14 to nothing now, West Virginia is still throwing some good licks, but they just gotten themselves into an early hold, and they must stop this drive right here if they're going to have any real chance of staying in this football game. Under a minute to play in this opening quarter.
The pressure has to come from the defensive ends, but they're keeping Tommy Briggs and Boris Graham off balance with the run pass game.
To see this one on instant replay.
I think they're going to call that he came through the back of the receiver.
Mm-hmm. Pass interference.
Pass interference
on the defense.
Horace Copeland runs a deep curl pass. Gino Toretta is going to seem wide open, throws the football. Kwame Smith, number 23, comes from behind, and there's the call. You making that noise for any particular reason?
No, I'm not. Don Nealon, one of the really nice guys in coaching.
And he's probably over there going,
he's probably going a little more than, I mean, he's has a lot of self-control.
First and 10 at the 22.
I have a feeling that Don probably did say, This could be the last play of this opening quarter. To the 19. Scott Gaskins also comes up to finish him off along with David Mayfield.
Sometimes when you're coaching in a game like this and you're just being, it's a one-sided game in the first quarter, you can't mutter words. The sounds come out because you're in shock of how well Miami's playing, and your team's playing good football, but Miami's just playing on a cloud right now.
Well, they really are. That's the end of the first quarter. So let's take a timeout. Miami, 14. West Virginia, nothing. Welcome back to Miami, Florida. Ron Franklin with Mike Gottfried and Adrian Karsten. And as we open the second quarter, for the Hurricanes, a second down. The line to make is the 12-yard line. This is the 10th play of this drive. Serrano going for the end zone. Got him there. Lamar Thomas saw it sail over his head. Gino had him open for a moment, but was not able to get it away in time.
Well, he was trying to go to Kevin Williams all the way over here on the right side, and Kevin Williams just was covered. And then he tried to go back to the backside to Lamar Thomas, but just ran out of real estate.
Good protection again. Etheridge, London, Green, Vickers, and Cristobal, as the Mountaineers have had a tough time penetrating that offensive front for the Hurricanes.
Big screen down for Miami here, Ron.
Pass complete to Bell at the 10-yard line.
Completed. Coleman Bell.
number 68, pass protection versus Tommy Briggs, a good solid defensive end who does beat the pass protection, but because of the quick passing game, the ball is already in motion.
Hey, Mike, interesting. He's more than 166. He actually weighs 236. But he is a converted tight end, and 236 is not big for an offensive tackle at all. Straight ahead with a running play, and Bennett has a couple, and he has to pay for it. Tim Brown is down at the bottom of that fray.
What happens, Ron, is what we were talking about. Just watch Tommy Briggs on that last picture beat the block of Carlos Etheridge, and the ball's in the air, and that's what Miami does to you. They frustrate you because when you do get a pass rush, the ball's already gone because they're throwing a three-step, five-step drop, and then all of a sudden when you start to blitz them, that's when they go downtown.
Boy, a big score in a big game in the ACC. Florida State trailing Virginia early, 3-0. The game that wouldn't change. Short drop, he zips it, incomplete. Chris Jones is the man he wanted. I think he wanted him to round out that route a little bit back toward him. Jones kind of took it straight.
You know, Toretta's already graduated. He's in the college school of business and graduate school. So Coach Erickson sending plays into a graduate school student.
Left until halftime. The Canes on top, 14-0. This time they get pressured, drills it in the end zone, and knocked down. Nice defensive play by Leroy Axon. That's what the Mountaineers have been needing, some kind of stopper, and they're going to force Miami to go for the Hurricane.
Leroy Axon, number one, the defensive back. First of all, both receivers are covered. Gino Toretta now tries to scramble to the left, throws across his body, doesn't get enough strength on the ball because he's rolling to the left, really didn't get set.
That was Rick Dolly who was putting the pressure on. This is a 24-yard attempt. Kick is up, and he is no good. Off to the right and no good.
Well, this is the break that West Virginia needs to just try to get some momentum for their offense. They're able to hold Miami. They fail on the field goal. Here's the hold. Paul Snyder, like a good hold.
Sure did. That's some great shots, guys, down in the truck. And, of course, he wants to say that it's good, but the official standing right underneath the goalpost said, no, sir, no way. So a 12-play drive goes awry.
Never seen a kicker yet to miss. They all think they make it.
Jim Freeman for a couple.
Here's the problem when you play Miami on offense, and when the offense of Miami gets you a 14-point lead, they just turn it loose now. They crank it up. So you have to be patient if you're Don Nayland in West Virginia, because you got to try to slowly get back in this thing offensively.
Because also Miami's just like any other club. If things come too easily, you can lose your concentration for a stretch, can't you?
What we talked about, that's the main worry of Dennis Erickson right now.
Is Freeman, and he's going to have the first down as he takes it out to the 31. Michael Barrow, along with Darren Smith, combining in the stop.
See, the game changes for with Darren Studstill in the ball game as opposed to Jake Kelchner, because Jake Kelchner is a drop-back quarterback, the starter who is back in Morgantown. Darren Studstill gives you a little extra time as he rolls there by some time for the receiver, Jim Freeman, to come open.
12:30 remaining until halftime. 14-0 Miami. Morrell cuts it back inside. Good cut, and he'll have 5 yards as Darren Smith is holding onto his arms.
Run down by Darren Smith. The gain is 4.
Well, as far as rushers in the nation and how they go, Morrell, Adrian the senior out of Hawaii, is number 4, averaging 126.5 per game.
may be the best running back in America that no one's ever heard of. Just been a silent performance by Adrian Morrell.
But tonight against this defense, it has been very sticky. You can see the 8 for 10 number. And there he breaks tackle, showing his strength. Has 5, has 10, 15, and across midfield to the 48 Morrell. As Terrace Harris will knock him out of bounds. And let's go down to Adrian Karsten.
Ron, here in the West Virginia sideline, starting to move the ball here a little bit now in Miami. Expect to see the counterplay. Now, Coach Gottfried brought this up short a moment ago. They just diagrammed the blocking scheme for that play. Remember, this is the play that Arizona ran against Miami, after which they couldn't run an inch. Now, no Miami defense has been able to stop that counterplay. It's usually called the Washington Redskins counter tray. Keep an eye open for it.
Adrian's right, Ron. Arizona had so much success with that counterplay with a tailback.
Morrell gets a breather. John Jones comes in replacing him. And he gets the call. Breaks off a tackle down the near side, and he'll take it inside the 40. And that is another Mountaineer first down. Paul White knocks him out of bounds, but it's a gain of 13.
Well, Adrian Karsten must be in the huddle over there, because that's what it's going to be, the tailback counterplay. Well, they're going to bring it backside, show the play on the front side. Here comes backside. And again, Miami has trouble with the counterplay. Arizona had so much success in that ball game, it bothered Miami. And everybody looks at that film. West Virginia is going to run that play tonight.
This time they take it to the right side. And another first down for the Mountaineers inside the 25 and down to the 21-yard line is John Jones.
Same play again to the other side. Here comes the tailback counter now to the right. John Jones. See the misdirection? The fullback goes one way. There's the pulling lineman. Now John Jones breaks through. There's no one there. Miami has problems with this play. Because of the misdirection, it slows down the speed of the defense.
And now the West Virginia side of the field getting fired up, and for good reason. Their best drive far and away of the night. And movement at the line of scrimmage. And I believe that somebody came out of their stance.
Dead ball. False start on the offense.
Mike, when you're a head coach on the sideline, this is just a killer. You come up with back-to-back-to-back first downs. You finally got up going, and then you aim that pistol at your foot.
Well, you just can't make mistakes against a team like Miami. But the next point of this tailback counter is to fake the tailback counter and then run Adrian Morrell opposite, throw the pass.
And all three linebackers, Farrell, Armstead, and Darren Smith, all blistering toward the football.
Okay, this is a ways away here from the blimp camera here we're going to telestrate from. We may not even be able to see the stadium. But the ball's good. Now here, again, when you see flow like this, Miami really reacts, so there's no counter here. Now both backs take it to the line, to the play, and you see how the Miami linebackers run. That's why the counterplay is a little bit more successful. Slows the linebackers down.
Mike, actually Warren sat because of penetration is the one who fouled up the play, shoving his blocker into the backfield. Got it complete. At the tight end, Al Johnson, close to the first down. In fact, I believe he's going to have it at the 12-yard line.
84, Al Johnson. Ryan McNeil.
This is what Darren Studstill brings to the table in offense. The fake of the running play. Now he's able, because of his running ability, to keep the play alive, to throw the pass and to get it open and to complete it for big yardage.
It is a Mountaineer first down. So the situation, first down, just outside the 10. They can pick up the first without scoring. Greeted with 9 different Miami Hurricanes. Michael Barrows, the man who led the attack.
Number 28.
You have Bobby to run some Twitter. Plays where there's full flow and not counters, believe me, because you have to keep them honest. If all you ran was counter plays, then they would settle into that kind of defense. But they're having success with misdirection against Miami and having zero success going right at them.
9 minutes, 30 seconds left until halftime. Hurricanes 14, West Virginia nothing, but threatening. Option play, into the boundary. Morrell
play against an option team, you have to play assignment football. West Virginia's trying to run the option into the short side of the field. See Darren Krein make the play. Now Michael Barrow is able to take the pitch without anybody blocking him, because they're able to get people up the field on that option.
Third down. The line of scrimmage is the 17, and they need to take it just inside the 2. Pass is caught by Jett, and a good open field tackle denied him inside the 5. Terrace Harris, the sophomore out of Memphis, is the man that took him on defensively.
Ron, if West Virginia's to have any chance to win this football game tonight, James Jett, number 15, has to be a major part of the offense. He has the speed to break the plays. He has the speed to break the little curl routes and can be a big-time deep threat because he has great speed.
Vander Jack comes in to attempt the field goal, and they're going to place this one down at the 13-yard line. A 22-yard attempt. At home. So the Mountaineers are on the scoreboard with 7:46 left until halftime. 14-3 our new score. PN's presentation of college football is being brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? And by Rockport. You should be in our shoes. Well, what a beautiful night in Miami, Florida. 14-3 our score. Things are a little brighter for the Mountaineers as you look at Kevin Williams. Absolutely one of the most dangerous kick return guys in the country. Let's take a look at this coverage from up top. This will be somewhat like the coach's video, but to give you an idea of where the lanes are. Kick out of the end zone, so we'll try it again next time to give you that same look. ESPN continues its exclusive coverage of Thursday night CFA games this week, beginning with the kickoff show at 7:45. And then Iowa State travels to Manhattan, Kansas to take on the K-State Wildcats. It's at 8 o'clock, so be sure and join Mike, Jerry Punch, and me next Thursday right here on ESPN. You don't think it'll be cold in Manhattan, do you?
I'll make a noise.
Now you're making noises. Gino Toretta.
And for the sweater.
A couple. Stephen McGuire's coming to the ballgame at running back. Toretta's pass is caught on the run by Copeland. Across the 40 to the 43, and Axum is right there to make the hit, but it's good for 23.
Here's a point for Gino Toretta. Now he's throwing the quick game of success. Now he throws the ball down the field. But you see the little move where he stepped up into the pocket? That's a veteran quarterback to avoid the rush, step up a yard in the pocket, drill the football to Lamar Thomas.
You see the pressure from the outside as the blitz comes and they get away the quick toss. Copeland has it, and a flag comes down. Ooh, there comes another one. Could be face masking against West Virginia. Tommy Orr.
Orr made the tackle.
Face mask on the defense.
Now, that was a perfect example of what Mike Gottfried's been talking about. The blitz came from the outside, and he threw the quick route.
Boy, he's smart, Ron. He's a veteran. He understands the offense. He has a new coach this year, Rich Olson, who is his new quarterback coach.
On the defense, 5 yards, first down.
Works with the wide receivers. Rich Olson was former secondary coach at Arkansas, so he understands defenses, but he has Gino Toretta really close up. There you see the face mask by Tommy Orr, number 24.
Shotgun formation. This time they get pressured, but because of the screen, and it's Jones, who had a 70-yarder earlier tonight, and he's off to the races, inside the 25 and down to the 21. Tim Brown finally puts a stopper on it. 20 yards in the play.
Well, we talked about screen downs for Miami. Gino Toretta feels the rush of West Virginia. calls the screen to Larry Jones. Opens up. Great block by Terrell Green.
Six minutes, 30 seconds remaining until halftime. Miami 14, West Virginia 3. Pass goes to McGuire. Flag comes down from the near side of the field. That is far away from the play. And he will have enough for the first down at the 10, but let's check the marker.
Play gained 11 yards. McGuire, run out of bounds, 10.
Holding. On the offense.
Let's go back to Tim Brando for an update. Timmy.
Well, when you've got the Hurricanes on, you want a Seminole update. That's for sure. Here's Charlie Ward. This is typical, right? He can't run the half-court offense, but put him in the press, and he can hit Tamarack Vanover. That's Charlie Ward doing what Charlie Ward does best.
First down.
So the Seminoles go back on top after go on top for the first time, actually.
Tim Brando, there'll be a lot of teams put that play in after they see the results of that little fumble there and then throw the ball.
Well, they're beginning to run together, but we saw an intentional play like that where the quarterback took the ball and banged the center again like he had fumbled it and then picked up and threw. First time we've seen that one this year. Pass to Thomas, right over the middle. Maximal hit him just short of the 25-yard line.
A couple weeks ago when Penn State played against Miami, they actually kept the defensive lineman inside when the pass developed to look for the middle screen of Miami. They're so concerned about it.
SDS representative for the press talk.
Fifth play of this drive. In the shotgun, the lineman in that ready position, throw is complete, and that's Coleman Bell, the tight end, will have the first down inside the 10. It's first and goal, King. Mayfield bumped him out.
It's kind of interesting here. Gino Toretta out of the shotgun will lift his leg up to show the center that he's ready for the snap. Now the center can take his head up to look who he blocks. You see the center's head's up now, and he centers when he's ready, not the quarterback. Kind of interesting there how they do that.
On first down, fakes it to McGuire, now reverses it in the end zone. He has a touchdown to Kevin Williams. Toretta is having some kind of night against West Virginia. Six straight completions on that drive, and the extra point by Swift is good. So let's take a look at Toretta's reaction as we head to commercial. 21-3, the Canes on top. But Toretta, six straight, and here's the culmination, a touchdown to Williams. Halloween night, and a lot of spooks and goblins in attendance tonight. Swift kicks it off. It's going to come down to Gallimore from the three. Ward with a good block. And Gallimore will take it to the 21-yard line.
Ron, here's what misdirection does to linebackers. Here's going to be the fake by Gino Toretta. Then he's going to come out the backside and hit the pass in the end zone. Watch the linebackers move with the fake. Now they can't recover. They're out of position. Kevin Williams sits behind them for the touchdown. A reverse angle look. You're on defense against Gino Toretta at home. See, all the time he has to throw the football with the misdirection, Kevin Williams for the score.
You know, Mike, you could see how high he was off the ground. The Miami receivers jumped so extremely well, which has to be a huge aid to a quarterback. This is Morrell, cuts it back against the grain, breaks it open. And finally stopped up close to the 40-yard line by Casey Greer. Now, this is the reason West Virginia's offense is beginning to click with the passing game.
Well, 6 foot, 200 pounds, Adrian Morrell has good size for a tailback. But watch his cutting ability. Steps into the hole, now good eyesight, there's a cut, now there's another cut. He's able to cut on a dime and make the cuts that slow down the pursuit of the Miami defense.
Boy, not many people do that against a speedy Miami defense, and Morrell tonight has ripped off a couple of really good ones. Finally on the positive side. Ooh. Darren Smith with the hit, and speaking of hits, here's Mr. Brando.
Right. Pull it off the top 40 survey here. A 5-yard smash for Dwight McFadden, giving SC its 7th rushing touchdown in as many games. Trojans lead Arizona State in Tempe 14-0.
Ron, do you think Tim Brando's old enough to remember American Bandstand, Dick Clark?
Oh, hey. He still has copies of that.
He's spinning those hits out of Philadelphia.
Darren Smith, a senior from right here in Miami. Short drop and a quick throw, and he's got it complete to Jet. James, an Olympic sprinter, senior out of Shenandoah Junction, West Virginia.
Darren Studstill, we talk about the decisions made on by Gino Toretto. Darren Studstill's making some good decisions. Getting to James Jett, the speedy receiver, because you get him one-on-one on the outside, James Jett. Very difficult to cover him. 6-for-8 for Darren Studstill for 67 yards.
Drills it over the middle, hit at the line of scrimmage by one of the defensive linemen, and I believe it was Klein who got a hand up.
Pass.
Darren Klein's very active in the defensive line. Hands up to try to deflect the pass. He really didn't get any penetration. He was just able to get his hands up. Number 91, Darren Klein being blocked, moving, but he's smart enough to get his hands up. Of course, the ball was thrown very low by Darren Studstill.
If Thompson had a good block on him, it passed, just thrown really low. Well, here's another dandy punt. Williams runs away from it, and it takes a Miami bounce. So let's call timeout. Sarvin's kick, good for 54 yards. We'll be right back. Three, our score with 4:07 left until halftime. And be sure to join Chris Berman, Tom Jackson, and Joe Theismann tomorrow morning for television's Emmy Award-winning pregame show, NFL Game Day. And of all the previews and features, including Best Barry, nobody knows about Barry Foster. And look at no-name Dallas defense. Then at 7 o'clock, the crew returns for the wrap-up and the highlight show, NFL Primetime, all tomorrow here on ESPN. And West Virginia was trying to call, and they did get it. A timeout as Axum went sprinting away from the line of scrimmage, signaling to call a timeout.
Timeout called before the snap.
The Hurricanes thank Mazda.
They had 11 men on the field. Could you tell what the problem was?
Unless they just don't do the bad defense for the play, the formation. Because the shotgun creates problems for you. If you decide like you're going to blitz the shotgun, you're short some people. So you have linebackers on receivers. So maybe Leroy Exum saved a very big play there by calling the timeout.
By the way, the overhead shots tonight are from the Goodyear Blimp Stars and Stripes. Goodyear Blimps are now in their 4th decade of participation in sports telecast.
Once we start talking about the presidential election, I'm sure Gino Toretto will carry the state of Florida.
Northwestern 26, South Carolina 24, Tennessee 23.
21-3, our score, as you look at that shot from Stars and Stripes high above the stadium.
San Diego State 20, Colorado State 13.
Mike, a lot of people have turned offensively to what Miami has found success doing, and that's the one-back offense. It's almost turned into the America's offense, I guess you could say.
Well, their opponent, Florida State, Washington, Don James came down here, looked at the offense and added to it. We'll talk a little bit about the one-back offense here in the next play.
Seven.
called timeout, but Lamar Thomas on the takeoff route. Leroy Axum couldn't be in any better position. Now, you're going to see Lamar Thomas break inside the two deep coverage. Now, Leroy Axum's in pretty good shape. Lamar Thomas just takes the football away.
You can see Leroy got turned around for just a moment, and that was enough for Lamar Thomas to have the concentration to grab it away from him. This is McGuire.
Talking about the one-back offense, what it allows you to do, just a couple quick things. It allows you to go into a game with a very simple game plan. You just build on because you have very few runs and very few passes, so you're forced to keep the game plan simple. Second thing is you spread the defense out with a one-back. You open up your running game. You allow your passing game to develop, and it's very difficult to blitz a one-back team.
About to go under 3 minutes left until halftime. The Hurricanes on top, 21-3. Blitz coming straight up the middle. Pass is caught by Bell, the tight end, at the 26-yard line. And Tim Brando, what do you have for us?
Arizona State is 5-1 in its last six home games. And here is the play fake by Grady Benton. And he rolls away from the SC pressure and then goes back the other way across the field to Bob Brasher. 14-7 with 1:42 left in the third.
So the Sun Devils account for one to make that a ball game of 14-7. West Virginia trying to keep the Canes out of the end zone. They're already down by 18. It's McGuire. That's a good play by Wes Richardson. You can see number 41 hanging on to him, the junior out of Bethel Park, Pennsylvania.
Well, he's the backup middle linebacker to Tim Brown, number 56, but he read the counter play perfectly and just able to scrape through and make the tackle unblocked.
Second down and 11.
But Gino Toretta, just like you talked about, a fine surgeon tonight. He's just reading the West Virginia defense. Anytime they blitz, he just picks them apart.
Nine straight completions for Gino Toretta. Look at that night, 17 of 21. Outside pressure, and he will be sacked. First time tonight that the Mountaineers have gotten to him, and it's Scott Gaskins along with Tom Briggs.
Scott Gaskins.
First time that West Virginia's able to get to Gino Toretta. Missed block by number 72, Christoffel. Tom Briggs in, Scott Gaskins, good pressure, big sack.
Third down at 24.
1:37 on the clock before halftime.
Well, that may have been just what Don Nealon ordered right there with the third down, and what they need to pick up is the 16-yard line for the first. Toretta dumps it out to McGuire, and Larry Jones, 23, had just come into the lineup. And he will be well short of the first down at the 37. And Mike, I don't know if Dennis will go for a 55-yard field goal or not.
Well, I would think you would punt the football here.
Fourth down at 21.
I think he's just going to take the delay of game and punt the football. Nope, now he's going to take a timeout.
Timeout taken by Miami. Take it with him. 53 seconds left until halftime. 21-3 Canes.
Monroe introduces road sensing technology. A new breed of Monroe shocks and struts that give you added control. New road sensing shocks and struts, only by Monroe. Designed to adjust automatically to give you added control without sacrificing comfort. Now comfort and control are automatic. New road sensing technology, only by Monroe.
Rust, what it can do to the outside of your car. Weak, neglected antifreeze can do to the inside. You need the tough anti-corrosion formula of Prestone. Use fresh Prestone every year to give your radiator and cooling system heavy-duty rust and corrosion protection. No matter what happens to the outside, Prestone protects the inside. Prestone stops the rust that stops your car.
Sony introduces the new standard in television. Trinitron XBR Squared.
Hey, look! The Grand Canyon!
It'll change the way you feel about everything you see. From Sony.
Welcome back to the Orange Bowl. 53 seconds left until halftime, and folks, this is the first Miami punt of this first half of play. Paul Snyder. And it is a what is called a punt safe formation for West Virginia. They got four linebackers and James Jett. You can see him back in a safety. They're not totally convinced that Miami is going to kick the football.
Well, Ron, what you do when the ball passes the 50-yard line, you have to get in a punt safe situation to prepare for the fake of some kind, because if you're going to see a fake, you're going to see it when they cross the 50-yard line.
Dead ball. Ball start on the offense.
Coming up at the halftime of the Delta Faucet Report, first Falk update. Washington's dominance as the Huskies won big today, and the Michigan scare up in the state of Indiana. All of that and more coming up at halftime. And he does kick it away. Jett will run away from it at the one and takes a West Virginia bounce. Now that's got to be touchdown. 42 yards on the kick. So West Virginia will have 42 seconds to work with. And I would imagine that they would be just happy with running that clock out. Good heavens, Ole Miss jumping on LSU tonight. Tonight is such a famous night in what has been a great rivalry between those two schools, but the famous Billy Cannon punt return, 1958, Halloween night. Ole Miss people will never forget it. That ruined an undefeated season. They lost it 7-3, but went on to face LSU in a rare situation in the Sugar Bowl that year and beat them 21-0 and held Cannon to minus yardage for the ballgame.
Was that Johnny Vaught?
Yes. Head coach Johnny Vaught. He had some great ones. In fact, Billy Brewer, who's now the head coach at Ole Miss, was one of the quarterbacks on that team. Pass thrown complete to Kappa, and the big tight end takes it up to the 34-yard line. Smith defensively.
Trying to go with a no huddle now to try to get some movement here in the offense. 35 seconds, moving the chains.
Block on the outside, gets his pass incomplete. Wild one right through James Jett's hands. And Ryan McNeil couldn't believe that he had a football in his hands real quick.
Well, Ryan McNeil didn't practice this week. He had a bad ankle and did not practice, but he's in the ball game tonight. Defensive coaches told me he may be the best defensive back they've ever had here in Miami.
Well, as I mentioned in the starting lineups tonight, there are a lot of scouts who say this young man might be the first cornerback taken in the upcoming draft.
25-second clock is out. Field judge to keep the 25 seconds.
Never feel like they'll call a 25-second violation when the clock's out, because just when you're coaching and playing a quarterback, you just take your time here in this period. Make sure you get the good play that you want and get time off.
Drills the pass. Incomplete. Boy, Kappa trying to catch the ball and then get out of bounds, and he tried to get out of bounds before he caught the football.
Steady tight end for West Virginia, John Kappa, the 6'3", 241-pound senior.
Oakmount, Pennsylvania, his home.
Father's a high school football coach in Pennsylvania. And a good one.
Hear the crowd, and it's Darren Smith. Any one of those linebackers, and you can get an ooh from the crowd.
Miami wants to force them to punt now, Ron, so they'll get a punt rush after West Virginia.
And if you ask yourself why, it's because when you have a weapon like Kevin Williams, you want to give him an opportunity. Don't be surprised if Don Nealon might even kick the ball out of bounds to make sure that they don't get an opportunity at that home run.
Well, both the offense of West Virginia still on the field, and the defense of Miami's on. Substitutions now. Here comes West Virginia's punt team, so Miami's punt return team will now on enter the field. You're right about Kevin Williams. I think he's as good a punt returner as there is in the country.
Sarbrunn warming up as you look at Kevin. And again, let's take a look at the coverage. By West Virginia. 49 yards in the kick and 12 on the return, and it's Wiley who makes the stop, and there is a flag down at the 23-yard line.
Illegal block in the back by the receiving team. He declined into the half.
So we are at halftime. The Delta Faucet Report follows after our timeout. Our score, the Hurricanes 21, West Virginia 3.
Neutralize the linebackers. Here you see Michael Barrel, number 56, pursue and make a play. Darren Smith, number 45, both Butkus finalists for the award, where he makes the tackle. The linebacker is just so aggressive, you have to neutralize them with counters and control them. Statistic-wise, Gino Toretta, 18 for 22, and of course, the 322 yards on total offense, just complete dominance in the first half.
Well, but looking at the numbers, as Mike said, it has been total dominance here in the first half of this ballgame, 21-3. Sauerbrunn to kick it off for West Virginia here in the second half of play as the Hurricanes deferred after winning the toss. And this one is a dandy all the way out the back of the end zone. And let's go down to Adrian Karsten.
Ron, I'll tell you something. Talking to Don Neal and gave his Mountaineers at halftime was loud enough to be heard out here. He said, look, Miami's good enough. You guys don't have to necessarily run the wrong way when you come and hit the hole. You got to get the job done at the line, offensively and defensively. Now, I said, by scheme, because Toretta's taking such a short drop back, three steps and then hitting those guys right over the middle, not going to blitz as much. They're going to drop back off the ball on defense.
Don Nealon trying to get his charges going. Nothing would excite him anymore than to have a stop here on this opening offensive sequence against Miami. Play action. Drills it over the middle and Bell. The tight end has it complete close to the 30.
When you counter and when you fake the run, the middle linebacker has to be able to get with the quarterback, eye him up, and move with him. There's the fake. There's the middle linebacker, Tim Brown, kind of lost as he drops back, and then Coleman Bell just hooks up inside of him for the completion. Tough on middle linebackers, Ron, the misdirection.
Donnell Bennett, the sophomore from Fort Lauderdale, gets the carry, and he'll have the first down.
This West Virginia football team is a frustrated football team. They had three tough home games in a row where a lot of strange things happened to them. And then to come off those games, come up a little bit empty, and then come on the road to play Miami is a very difficult task.
First and 10 for the Hurricanes, 34.
Bennett goes in motion to the bottom of your screen. Toretta with the quick toss, and again it's Bell. And the tight end will have to pick up to about the 33, 34-yard line.
Well, Adrian Karsten, in his report, talked about Don Nealon, says, we're going to play zone coverage, and we're only going to rush four people. Now watch the pass protection that the Miami offensive line is allowed to give against four people. You have five people working against four, so you should be able to protect your quarterback.
Bennett on the carry. Crosses the 45, has the first down, plus 10. Mike Collins, a junior out of high Huntington, West Virginia, makes the defensive play.
Ron, that philosophy's okay, but you're going to have to get some type of mix. I'm sure Don Nayland realizes that also, because what you're hoping is Miami self-destructs a little bit, make them go 80 yards, and they'll make some mistakes and just make them work the length of the field. But this Miami team is too on tonight. They're on offense, so you really have to try to surprise them or mix something up to throw them off balance. Blitz look.
Good pass, incomplete, and of now here comes a flag. Copeland was the man they wanted the pass to go to, and Axum is the guy who came over the top.
Well, this is a good call by the Miami by the West Virginia defense.
On the defense, spot foul, automatic first down.
Doesn't work out well, but what they tried to do is disguise a blitz, and they have Gino Toretta fooled. First time tonight they have him fooled into thinking it's a blitz. Leroy Axum's in great position. They're calling it on the left hand on the back. Leroy doesn't think he interfered.
And of course, Leroy is from Miami, and he would like to have a good showing tonight. He's one of 15 on this Mountaineer club from the state of Florida. Dumps it out as a flag comes down. Bennett at the 38-yard line, and from where this one has been thrown, it would appear it's going to be offensive holding to be called against the Hurricanes.
This is what Don Nayland's talking about in his philosophy of defense in the second half. Make them make a mistake. Let them make a hold. Maybe they'll drop a pass. Maybe they'll blow a blocking assignment and then push them back. Don looks like he's played tonight.
You know what? I mentioned it is a comfortable night. Actually, it's very humid, and particularly for the youngsters from West Virginia. And depth would become an important thing in the second half of the ballgame, wouldn't it, Mike?
Well, it really does. And I think that's the difference in this Miami football team. They always have good second-team players. Like when Rusty Medeiros gets hurt, Patrick's able to move in there, and they just don't drop any.
Sings this one over the middle, has it complete. And that's Darryl Spencer. You can see he juggled it for just a moment. Darryl, a senior out of Merritt Island, Florida.
It's interesting about this football team, because when you talk to coaches in Miami, they say, listen, the peer pressure from player to player, they make you practice hard. They make you play hard. The alumni players, they stay in contact with this program. They force the intensity up so that this team knows they have to play each week.
The legacy is left and continues to grow. 12 straight completions for Toretta. Has this one to Bell wide open again, and he will be inside the 15-yard line. In fact, they'll spot him down at the 9. Tim Brown got him, but it's a gain of 32.
We're going to look at it from the blimp, and Coleman Bell, the tight end, being covered by number 56, the middle linebacker, Tim Brown. So see Bell break off. Now Tim Brown has to chase him. Has to be a bust in the coverage there for Coleman Bell to be that wide open.
As you can tell by the number, Coleman started out to be a wide receiver wearing 17, and he has nearly that kind of speed, but he plays it wide at tight end. Bennett, big hold at the 2, at the 1, he will score. To attempt the extra point as the Canes try to go up by 25 points over West Virginia. Knocks it home, and let's take a break. 11:33 left in the third quarter. Our new score, Miami 28, West Virginia 3. ESPN's presentation of college football is being brought to you by Toyota and their full line of quality cars and trucks. Toyota, I love what you do for me. designed by Wrangler, the most comfortable jeans known to man. Now that moon right there, a Halloween moon over the Orange Bowl in Miami, Florida. And so far, it has been a beautiful moon for the Canes, number one ranked, as they have shown their dominance. Gallimore from the three.
What doesn't show up in tomorrow's statistics is decisions by the quarterback. He looks over the defense and sees there's only six people in the box. Makes the checkoff to the running play. There's the checkoff. Alerting his tail back, Donnell Bennett, that he's going to run the football. Now watch it open up. Terrell Green, number 51, with a block, and you have a touchdown.
Just look at it real speed and look at the power. And you're right. The block for the center, Green, occupying his man just long enough. And then the power and into the end zone. Dunstill got a man open. And it's intercepted by Casey Greer. Jet had broken behind the defensive back, and he was behind him 2 to 3 yards, and he underthrew it.
Darren Studstill was under pressure by Mark Caesar, number 99, who chased him and forced this interception. Mark Caesar, number 99, just pressuring Darren Studstill. Casey Greer, number 29, on the other end of the pass. He's going for the juggler right now.
Yep. Daniel Ferguson has checked into the ballgame, a true freshman. He is from Miami Columbia High School. I think he's going to be awfully good. And they're going to go up on top for the whole thing. And Copeland had it and dropped it. Oh, my goodness. This place would have gone Halloween mad.
Well, as we just talked about, they're going for the juggler, boy. When you see blood, this Miami football team's like a shark in water right now. Gino Toretta up on top to Horace Copeland, a well-thrown football. Now, there's another point by Gino Toretta.
This ends his streak. He had completed 13 straight, and it should have been 14.
Well, this should have been a completion. Do you have any question on Gino Toretta's arm strength? Watch this football. Well-thrown deep throw, and the reaction of Gino Toretta.
He's already got 286 yards. That would have been a 64-yarder. This is Ferguson. Takes it for a couple. Scott Gaskins steps up into the hole to make the hit on him.
One thing about a football season, I know everybody likes to talk Heisman, but it's a long season. You talk about injuries. You talk about each week the performance level has to remain the same. One thing about Gino Toretta, he's won and won big here at Miami with a great football team.
Third down, the line to make the 46. Williams, the intended receiver, and it was Mike Collins who had the cover.
Don Nayland has to be happy with that series defensively in the play of Mike Collins, number 25. This team's been through so much in the last 3 weeks, but I'll tell you one thing you don't see in them. You don't see quit in them. Continue to play very hard on defense.
Paul Snyder with only his second punt of the evening, and he kicks to a very dangerous one in James Jett. This is returnable. Jet from the 30. Gets a block, and now here comes a flag, a second and a third, as Jet comes all the way back across the field and will be shoved out of bounds inside the 35-yard line. Yards on the kick and 35 on the return.
I'll say this, Ron. It was a clip. It looked like to me a clip, but the crowd helped the official make this call.
Clipping on the return thing.
The left side of your screen. James Jett, number 15, number one, Leroy Axum is called for the clip.
Thank you. close. It was hard to tell on that shot right there whether he did in fact get his head in front, which of course is the key.
I think he clipped him. Take another look here.
I don't know.
See, I don't even know if he made contact, but he's down around the ankles.
See, if, as you well know, if the player turns his body, if your head is in front, then you can't be called for the clip. It's just by a fraction. Just by a fraction. Good call. Morrell on the carry, and he will take it across the 22 to the 23-yard line. You just joined us, 28-3. The Miami Hurricanes on top. We've just gone under 10 minutes to play in the third quarter. Some of the crowd here tonight at the Orange Bowl almost filled to capacity. A few people went on to the Halloween parties early. Some very ghoulish scenes around the stadium here tonight, which we'll be looking at as we come to a close. Morrell again, another great cut, and another one. Finally hit from behind at the 35, and it's Crine who had to come from way downfield to make the hit.
Well, there's 2 points here. First of all, Adrian Morrell's cutting ability is something to see because he is making people miss him. Watch as he breaks into the line of scrimmage. There's the first cut. Now the second cut. Now you avoid people. The third, the fourth. But Darren Crine never gives up. The big defensive lineman, number 91, comes all the way from back down the line of scrimmage to make the play.
And Adrian Morrell is shaken up after that play. Adrian Karsten, let's get a report from you.
Well, Ron, you and Coach make a great point about Crine being able to chase down those plays. Aside from the terrible disaster that Hurricane Andrew was, if it could ever have been a blessing in disguise for anyone, could have been Darren Crine, because he could eat no more than rice, apples, and bananas the week after that hurricane. He lost 7 to 8 pounds and never gained the weight back. He says his pursuit is much better because of that weight loss.
First down, Abel from the 38-yard line. Stutzfield puts it on a hip, got a blocker in front. We'll have 5, we'll have 10. And now as he goes across midfield, is tackled at the 47-yard line.
Darren Stutzfield just was on the back of his right guard, Dale Williams, number 65, and was allowing him to lead the blocking.
Mack Brown in North Carolina continuing to roll. That was a come-from-behind victory by them today.
Well, there's a big game right there. Will Dooley, Wake Forest, in his final season. A solid football coach, and he's going to be missed in the coaching profession.
Wake upsets Clemson. 15 yards in the last play. Set still over the middle, way overthrown. He wanted Kearney. And, you know, he has been a quiet one tonight. He's the leading pass receiver for. I beg your pardon, the second leading receiver with 12. But he hasn't had one so far this evening. The lights of Miami on a Halloween evening. Number one Miami trying to make a statement to the country. This is John Jones. He'll take it to the 45-yard line, and Harris is there to trip him up.
Terrace Harris, number 6. Great name, isn't it, Terrace Harris?
He could be part of our old
all
name team.
Team.
Can't be part of our old hair team, which we started last week. So.
Both safeties are for Tennessee, from the state of Tennessee. Memphis, Tennessee, matter of fact. Terrace played at Whitehaven High School, and Casey Greer, the strong safety, played at Hamilton High School in Memphis.
Third down, and the Mountaineers need the 37. Pressure from the backside, going to be hit by Marley, and tackled at the 41-yard line.
They love this kid here on this football team, Rohan Marley. He was hurt before the Iowa game. They found out he had a stress fracture, and they told him he was going to have to sit out the game. He goes, I'm not sitting out this game. He played against Iowa with a stress fracture. Then they put his leg in a cast. Look at how smart he is to try to strip the ball away from Darren Stutzfeld.
This front to punt as he stands back at the 29. Flags come down.
Dead ball. False start on the offense.
Look at that average tonight. Of all the things, as you take a look at Kevin Williams back in a single safety, of all the things that have been done well by West Virginia tonight has been the punting of this young man. Williams from the 23. Again, good coverage by West Virginia, and here comes the flag into the tackling area. Taparewski downfield to make the stop. 44 yards on that punt.
West Virginia's played very well in the special teams tonight.
Yep, they have.
Illegal block in the back by the return team.
So the Canes will start it off deep in their own territory. Let's take a timeout. 7:03 left in the third.
Today, for the first time in half a century, America is not at war. And America's wartime economy is changing to a peacetime economy. But that change has brought fear and uncertainty. The fear of losing a job, of losing a home. The uncertainty of tougher economic competition from around the world. But with change comes opportunity. And my agenda for American renewal can be the bridge to the future. It provides a choice of quality schools so our children have the knowledge to compete. It provides job training so workers have the new skills to compete. It provides health care for all and controls spiraling costs so our people can afford to compete. And my agenda strengthens small businesses that create two of every three jobs so we have the new jobs to compete. Today, we stand at the threshold of a new era. We change the world around us. Together, we must do the same at home.
When I hit 100,000 miles, I was driving home from a bat cave where I'd just seen 6 million bats.
I'd say it would be,
When I hit 200,000 miles, I was on my way to a 100th birthday party.
Okay,
it happened right where the fence starts on the Lamont Bridge.
I don't remember the specific place I was at.
Where were you when your Toyota truck hit 100, 200, 300,000 miles or more? Tell us about it.
I never stopped really paying attention to mileage until it reached about 400,000.
Next Saturday, it's a game that could determine who goes to the Orange Bowl. Nebraska hunts down Kansas on ESPN.
Miami cheerleaders enjoying what's happening tonight. It's a 25-point bulge by their football team with 7:04 left in this third quarter. And Miami takes it over following the penalty with the ball just across their own 15. And let's go back to Tim Brando for an update. Tim, what do you have for us?
The old coach of Miami, Howard Schnellenberger, who brought them their first national championship, has had a tough sledding on the road. He's lost 8 straight games on the road. Here, Ralph Dawkins in from 10 yards out. DeVille leads Cincinnati 27-17 in the fourth.
Second down. Howard's playing a big-time schedule, I'll tell you. And that Louisville team just plays competitively every week. So Howard's done a nice job there at the University.
Again, right up the middle. Earlier in the ball game, in case you missed it, back in the first half, he zipped one for 70 yards. His first carry of the night, which is a pretty good way to open the evening. And it also devastated this West Virginia club because the Hurricanes had just gone on top 7-0, and then that rapidly, it all of a sudden was 14.
Just turned over my shoulder, Jim Brock from the Cotton Bowls here. I'm sure all the bowl people are here looking at Miami, and I think West Virginia's still a bowl team. They've got to win some games here at the end, but I think they're a solid football team that should be considered.
Osbrock. Third down and short. Straight ahead with Jones, and he goes across the 32 to the 33. Well, the Heisman watch, and let's show you what happened today. The nation's leading rusher, an injury to the quad muscle, 60 yards for him today against Colorado State. Then Garrison Hurst for the Georgia Bulldogs, 41 yards rushing. 54 yards receiving the football. And Toretta tonight, 286 yards and two touchdowns. And in the first half, when it was 17 of 22. Play action by Toretta. Zips it out. That's Spencer. Darryl Spencer will be pushed back from the 40-yard line.
Miami's been able to control the linebackers in West Virginia with a little play-action passing game. Just enough time to be able to get the ball off to Darryl Spencer, number 35, and the other receivers.
Under 5 minutes left in this third quarter. Toretta with three wide receivers to the left, and here comes McGuire, hit in the backfield, and that's a fine play by Wes Richardson, the middle linebacker. There's two pulling guards. You could see them, Mike, and he just cut in right behind him.
Well, that's the second play he's made on that counter. He just reads that counter so well. When he sees it develop, he comes behind the block of the pulling guard and tackle to make the play. Wes Richardson, 6'2", 230-pound junior linebacker, see him step right behind the pulling guard to make the play on Stephen McGuire.
Shotgun on third down, and Toretta has it complete, but well, they're going to give him enough for the first down at the 45-yard line. Kevin Williams made the catch. Leroy Axum came up quickly to make the tackle. I think the official thought Leroy was patting him, but he was patting Kevin Williams, actually.
Miami went to the no-back shotgun. They spread the whole field, and you got one-on-one all over the place. Oh, Mississippi. Ole Miss. Wow. LSU's playing a lot of young players, though.
Yep, they are.
Be patient.
Big game for the folks from Ole Miss, though. Rivalry particularly. Pass behind Kevin Williams. And that actually is the first bad throw that the Geno has had tonight. He just clearly threw it behind him. And the way he's played tonight, he deserves one. It's not right on the money.
24 of 31, 298 yards, two touchdowns. But as I said earlier, the decision for Dennis Erickson's football team, they won't show up in the scorebook, but he has made some excellent decisions tonight, checking off on plays.
You can see even Dennis was kind of amused, shaking his head as Kevin Williams came off the field saying, "I don't know." Pressure up the middle. He sets the screen and has it to McGuire. At the 50, 45, and is knocked out of bounds around the 45-yard line. 15 yards in the screen play.
Rick Dolly, number 62, one of the West Virginia defensive linemen. We're so high here. Look at here. See him? They really read screen the defensive lineman, but Gino Toretta's just quick enough to get the ball out to Stephen McGuire for the big play. Well, we know the guys up in the blimp aren't sleeping. Air traffic control could be assured they're awake.
Blitz from the outside. Turn. He is hit from behind, and Toretta gets annihilated by Graham. Wow. Tim Brando, what do you have for us?
I got that point guard turned quarterback, Charlie Ward, going to work against Virginia and Charlottesville. And Ron and Mike, don't discount what Florida State has done this year in the ACC. They've won at NC State, are winning at Virginia, have already won at Georgia Tech and at Clemson. Not easy.
Well, that's a great point, Tim. Plus the fact, another point that does not make people sleep easy up there, is next year, Florida State does not lose a lot of folks, and all those people have to come to Tallahassee and play. Think about that one. 2:40 left in the third quarter. 10th play of the drive, and that one is complete. Lamar Thomas at around the 40-yard line.
Talk about Florida State, O'Ron, and you're looking at the team tonight that's been the nemesis for Bobby Bowden.
Is that amazing?
I mean, this team has just played lights out when they play Florida State.
Look at this pass distribution. 15 to the wide receivers, 3 to the running backs, and 8 to the tight end, and particularly, well, Bell actually has caught them all. Throwing. I want to make a point, and we'll come back and talk about the Florida State thing instead.
He's throwing a pass to everybody but Dennis Erickson.
All out pressure. Coretta gets it away, and it's intercepted. Nope, they say he did not hold on. David Mayfield, with a great diving effort, couldn't come up with it. And it was Boris Graham, you could see, 55, coming after Terrell.
This is the first play that West Virginia really got pressure on Gino Toretta, where they force him into a bad throw for an interception. David Mayfield stretches out with a great effort, just can't hold on to the interception.
I think David's okay, but you could see him kind of grasp at that shoulder a little bit. He really made a super effort to try to come up with the intercept. He came down hard in the shoulder. James Jett, the return man for the Mountaineers. Good angle as you get the look at from the end zone, and it will go into the other end zone. 39 yards in the kick. Let's take a break. Canes, 28-3.
Amendment 10 is really bad news, St. Pete Times. It is risky and unfair. We recommend a no vote, the Florida Times Union. Amendment 10 will cause your property taxes to go up because it only caps assessments. Amendment 10 will make it harder to buy or sell a home. The respected Florida Tax Watch says the amendment contains too many negative aspects to support. Floridians should vote no on Amendment 10. On November 3rd, let's send a message to the rich. We are tired of unfair taxation. Vote no on Amendment 10. If you want the...
There you see the score, 28-3 with 1:44 left in the third. And now for tonight's Toyota Leadership Award winners. From West Virginia, center Mike Compton. He carries a 3-5 in physical education and health and is a volunteer at the West Virginia Children's Hospital. And from Miami, it's quarterback Gino Toretta. He's a graduate student with a 3-4 in Miami's MBA program. And also, he is involved in the Join a Team, Not a Gang program with the Metro-Dade Police Department. Toyota, proud to donate $1,000 to each school's general scholarship fund on behalf of these two fine athletes. And our congratulations to both. Well-deserved. Morrell gets it to the outside, makes one cut, makes another, and then runs out of real estate at the 30. Mike, he has gotten far, far more impressive as this game has gone on. It's almost like he lathered up a little bit.
Well, he's played very well. He's made some good runs for West Virginia. They just haven't been able to get the balance with him in the passing game to try to open up both phases of the game that you need, the run and pass.
You know, the point that you were making about Miami and what I said about Florida State, you take at least a couple of wins, and two or three of those national championships might be at Tallahassee rather than down here in Miami. But this is a club they couldn't beat. Pass incomplete, and that's good defense by Marley. And let's go back to Tim Brando.
You know, USC, guys, is only maybe, a turnover or two away from being unbeaten and once tied. Here, David Webb sacks Arizona State's Grady Benton for his safety. With just seconds remaining, it's 23-13 Trojans.
Well, it was almost like they turned their season around when they went to Norman, Oklahoma, and played the Sooners. They picked up a fumble that was costly to Oklahoma, grabbed the momentum away after they scored that touchdown, and they never trailed again. Touchdown pass incomplete, and I think he just threw it away. That was Krein, who was putting the pressure on Studstill.
Ron, I want you to look at Warren Sapp here. He's 6'3", 280, number 76. Coaches feel like he's a clone of Jerome Brown, the great player here. They said he has more athletic ability than any player on this team. Now, he's 280. Last year for the scout team, he used to catch punts, and he would try to catch them one-handed. And that's the kind of athlete you're looking at there, Warren Sapp, number 76.
Six straight incompletions for West Virginia. Oh, is that a great picture with the sod in the face mask?
Say, reminds him of Jerome Brown.
Dunstill's pass goes on top for Jett, and it's going to be intercepted by C.J. Richardson. Flag down back at the 25-yard line, so let's check it quickly.
Holding on the
Darren Studstill as he heads to the sideline. Just put a little bit too much air under this football. He's trying to get the ball to James Jett. Number 15 just threw it a little bit too far, but C.J. Richardson has the presence of mind to stay in bounds and then pick up some valuable real estate to put good field position for the Miami offense.
Second interception by Miami tonight. Place to go, and he just dumps it away, and he had somebody close enough that it won't cost him. He wanted the tight end, but defensively West Virginia with Derek Wiley was all over Coleman Bell.
Gino Toretta wisely threw the ball away as some of the other people here in the election tried to rush him to take some votes away from him. Forrest Graham, I don't want to say us, from him. Forrest Graham really put pressure on him.
We need more than votes, Michael. 42 seconds left in this third quarter. Coretta's pass incomplete. And Spencer, very uncharacteristically, had it hit him on the hands, and he dropped it.
This West Virginia defense has been on the field a long time, and they still continue to play very aggressively. Still playing good pass defense. Not getting much of a rush on Gino Toretta, but still playing good, solid defense.
Secondly, playing in the ball game, Matt Tofoni started tonight, and he went out in the first period. We haven't seen him since. To get back to Matt, he's an interesting story. His dad played at West Virginia, went on to play in the pros. And Toretta gets steamrolled by his own guys. The blocking continues.
Keith Morris, number 94, is the first player to get up in the face of the quarterback, Gino Toretta. Keep watching the defensive line as they keep working up the field. Keith Morris, number 94.
You can see Cristobal continue to block against Tom Briggs, and that was the reason for the disagreement. Barely gets this one away. Good coverage kick as a fair catch is called for and made by Jett at the 25. And that is the end of the third quarter. 26-yard punt. Let's take a break. We'll come back with the final 15 minutes from the Orange Bowl.
The 1993 Toyota Tercel not only comes with a standard driver's side airbag, it's also Toyota's lowest priced four-door sedan. Why four doors? Because you never know when you might need the extra room.
Don't even think about it.
What?
Well, Gino Toretta visiting with Rusty Medeiros in the sideline. And, of course, you know that Rusty was lost early on in the season with a leg injury. But here on the bench to cheer on his teammates. Quarter of play. Morrell breaks it out to the 35, and it's very close to a 10-yard gain. There was a time in this ball game when we showed you a graphic. He had 8 carries for only 10 yards, and Mike, since then, he has run as well against this football team as any running back has this year. He now has 87 on 7 carries. All over him. That's 5 tackles, we're told, for Marley already in this ballgame.
Well, I know you're a reggae fan, singing fan, so you can tell him who his father is.
His father's Bob Marley.
The famous singer, right?
But yeah, that's... Actually, you knew that, Mike, and I didn't.
I'm into reggae music. But a great play by Rohan Marley. 5'8", 200-pound freshman. Trying to widen your culture. I don't want to get you out of that country western music a little bit every now and then.
Third down. catch of the night up at the 44-yard line to keep this drive alive. It's good for 14 yards.
Darren Stutz, though, shows a strong arm on this completion to Jay Kearney. Curl route, 14-yard route. Nice, strong throw by the junior quarterback.
It's got to be a terribly difficult situation for Studstill. You remember last year in the opening game against Pitt, Studstill was the starting quarterback. He was injured, then lost the job to Kelchner, and then comes on, retakes the job because of the injury, and he has to come to the Orange Bowl to play against Miami. Not easy stuff. Pass intended for Al Johnson. He took a pretty good shot after that ball was overthrown.
Everybody tries against cover two where there's two deep secondaries to try to get the tight end down the middle. Al Johnson, number 84, just the ball was just overthrown a little bit, but I believe if Al would have caught that, he would have been lit up by the two safeties of Miami.
Partially anyway, as he took a pretty good lick. Garrett Ford has come into the backfield as West Virginia goes I formation. Ball is swallowed up, and it's Marley, the first man there to make the hit.
He's one of those kind of players that just makes plays. Tom Tuberville, a great linebacker coach here for the Miami Hurricanes, who's been with Jimmy Johnson here and stayed with Dennis Erickson. You see him right there giving the signal. He just says Rohan Marley makes plays. And he said if you're around the pile, even his own players know that if they hear him coming, he's going to hit somebody.
Well, is he singing in reggae? Is that how they know when he's coming?
I think he hums in reggae.
Third down. The line to make is down at the 46. Studstill now dumps the pass off and has it completed. That will be enough for the first down. And that's the first catch by Ed Hill tonight, the leading receiver for West Virginia.
Darren Studstill held on to the football just long enough to make the coverage come to him, and then he dumped the ball to number five, Ed Hill.
Mike, you can see Johnson there. He turned into the headless horseman on this Halloween night. It just kept going without his headgear. Watch this. See the headgear come off? And he continued pursuit. Dunstill backside, has a man there. Oh, in and out of his hands, and Kearney couldn't hold on to it. And in his defense, the ball was tipped just prior to getting to his hands.
He got behind Dexter Siegler, number 34, and was open for the touchdown.
Boy, I
just couldn't hold on to the football. Darren Studstill's reaction.
11:56 left to play in the ball game. It's the Hurricanes 28, West Virginia 3. Ford for a moment had a huge opening, then it closed up. Greer, one of the first men to get there.
Ron, I still think this West Virginia football team has an excellent chance to go to a bowl. They've had a tough, like you say, tough home schedule at Boston College, Syracuse, Penn State. Now come on the road to Miami, but they close, and I believe they'll close strong. I think in adversity, sometimes a lot of great things happen, and this ball club has zero quit in it. They're playing hard. They made some mistakes, but this is a pretty good football team.
Well, that's Caesar, who was shaken up on the play and being helped off. Well, again, I want to say a special thanks to Captain Maloney and the crew of the Goodyear ship, Stars and Stripes. Our overhead shots tonight, courtesy of Goodyear Tires. Captain Maloney, I hope things are well up there. It has been a beautiful evening. The wind really negligible. Nothing there as far as the problem. Studstill puts it up. Going to go for Jet. The five knocked away and a great defensive play by Siegler. Hung up just a little too long.
You're not going to see many better defensive plays than Dexter Siegler makes on James Jet. They brought a blitz. Now they're in man coverage. James Jett, 15, breaks away from Dexter Siegler, watching his right hand up to deflect the football. Reverse angle, the right hand up, deflects the football away from James Jett.
Just the difference in one step further with the football. It is fourth down. They need the 30-yard line to keep it alive. Stepstill has it complete at the 29-yard line. Ed Hill on the receiving end.
Ed Hill took a lick also, but was able to hold on to the football.
You know, Mike, as they change some players right here, one of the things we noticed last night as we walked on the floor of the Orange Bowl, some stadiums you come into, they're well-groomed and all, but the grass is sitting up here pretty high. This is cut as a fast track. I mean, it is cut down there low. In golf, you talk about what it is on the step meter.
This is a speed field, you're right.
Drop lay, and Derek Ford is going to be stopped, maybe a loss of one on the play.
You cut your field according to your team. Unless you have AstroTurf, then you have no choice. But you have a choice here. So you have a speed team in Miami. Cut that grass as low as you can.
You know, people used to say in the pros, they used to accuse Al Davis of watering down between the hash marks and then having to fast track on the outside for those wide receivers. And let's go down to Adrian Karsten for this update.
One of the reasons the track is so fast is the way they cut this grass around. They actually roll a big steel roller with spikes on it, and they pull these little mud plugs out of the field, aerates the field, lets some air and water get in there. That's why these guys like it so much.
You see him pull the guards. It's the counter tray, and no place for the running back, Adrian Morrell, to go. He will be stopped one of the few times tonight here since the first quarter for a loss. Ran into Dale Williams.
There just was no place for Adrian Morrell to run. Damon Bethel, number 46, was also in on the tackle. Don Nayland still coaching over there, still trying to get that ball in the end zone.
The son-in-law, Jeff Hostetter, quarterback for the New York Giants. He said they talked two or three times each week. They stay in close though. Pressure coming up the middle. Stepstill gets away from it. Now goes for the end zone. And it is tipped away. And in fact, an opportunity to be intercepted by either Greer or Richardson. And they kind of took it away from each other.
Well, they're trying to get the ball to James Jett again, their speedster, down the middle of the field. Well covered by C.J. Richardson and Casey Greer. Well covered. You know, Ron, you talk about West Virginia. This is a program with a lot of pride. When I was at Pitt, we used to play them. They have great fan support. The fans are really into it up in West Virginia. You've been there.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, they love their football and their basketball. Gail Catlett, and a program with a lot of pride and a lot of history.
Fourth down. Stepstill under pressure. Gets by one. Will not get by Darren Crum. And the Hurricanes will take over at the 46. But it was Lopez who forced him into the arms of Prime. So there's a timeout on the field. 8:58 left in the ball game. The Canes by 25.
It all started 35 years ago. I'll never forget that day.
David. Gotta go.
It's funny, though. You grow up, raise a family, your priorities change. Of course, there are some priorities that never change. The trick is to make a decision now that you'll be happy with for years to come. When it's all said and done, I think it all goes back to that day 35 years ago.
David, are you out there?
On November.
ESPN's presentation of college football is being brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, builders of fine automobiles since 1886. And by Anheuser-Busch, who proudly brings you Family Talk. Let's stop underage drinking before it starts. Now, the good look at the young man who just ended that fourth down try by West Virginia. Prime makes the tackle behind the line of scrimmage, and the Canes take it over again. Donnell Bennett will take it straight ahead to the 45. And it's been a tough night for that offensive unit. Boy, Kentucky trying to pull the big upset tonight over Jackie Sherrill's Mississippi State ball club. Florida with a big win. Congratulations to Steve Spurrier and his fellows in the tea party or cocktail party. What a win by South Carolina, too. That's three in a row, Mike. Nobody would have predicted any of the three, would they? Paredes pass. He's caught and enough for the first down for Lamar Thomas. It's going to be offsides, I believe, against West Virginia. You could see the jump by Boris Graham.
Offside on the defense.
Well, let's take a look at the Heisman watch very quickly in case you missed what the gentleman did today. Falk with 60 yards and he had to leave the game with an injured quad muscle. And what about Hurst? Not a big day rushing. 41 yards, had 54 in receiving yards. And we asked Gino Toretta how he liked being labeled the Ross Perot of the Heisman race.
Well, they've got a point, but let's live in a world of reality. I think the principal issue that separates me is I do have a lot of experience in getting things done.
Well, Gino has a terrific likeness. That actually was Ross Perot, of course, from the last debate. Gino is going to get a lot of attention tonight for this performance.
I'll tell you, Gino Toretta ought to try to knock Rich Little out. The way he sounds just like Ross Perot.
Well, it's Halloween. He was posing as Ross. Under 8 minutes to play. Bennett. And he will take it inside the 45. And you got to start thinking soon here that Dennis would be taking him out of the ballgame. Because with a 25-point lead, last thing in the world you want to do is see him go down. Wouldn't you imagine?
Yes, I would. I think Dennis is probably saying this is the final drive for this first-team offense. And, 7:40 on the clock. This guy's done a nice job here, Dennis Erickson. You know, Howard Snellenberg, you have to give him credit. He started this program. He took it when the program was really down and built this thing.
Well, you can see the blitz coming from the secondary. The pass well overthrown and incomplete. Graham knocked him down after the pass was thrown, but the pressure coming from the inside. Segley is the man putting the pressure on.
Indiana has come back on Minnesota. Jim Sweeney at Fresno State up 7-0. Murray team's down again, but it's not over yet.
Someone could be going after your passing record, Mike.
No, it's only third quarter.
You can see the short drop, and Kevin Williams didn't come up quickly enough to make the reception there. You get the feeling in watching Miami here in the second half that the emotion is not what it was in the first half of play.
No, and I'll say this. They came out really intense to play. I think West Virginia did also. I think West Virginia, I keep talking about their football team. I think you're seeing some things that are going to happen to this West Virginia program. I think they're on the verge of some good things happening. They're going to come together as a football team. You can't have three straight weeks like they had, play Miami, and not something good come out of it because they played good hard football. They deserve better results than what they attained.
I agree with you. Toretta calls the timeout, so we'll take it with him. 7:16 left to play in this one. Miami.
University of Miami, Salute Rider System.
Here. There. Everywhere. The DeskJet Portable. DeskJet printers from Hewlett-Packard. Make it happen.
We're back from the Orange Bowl. Ron Franklin, Mike Gottfried, and Adrian Karsten on this Halloween evening with only 7:16 left to play. Miami leading 28-3. Pass to Bennett on the screen. Looks for a block. Gets one still on his feet. And finally will be stopped down at the 22-yard line.
Well, Miami just set this screen up beautifully. Gino Toretta with a little drop and then dumps the ball off to Donnell Bennett. Good yardage. Horace Copeland, number 88, with a big block.
Attendance tonight, 51,246. You see the number one Miami Hurricanes play. You see the blitz from the outside. Pumps once, going to go on top. All alone is Thomas. Touchdown. Now here comes a flag, and we may have a question of did he push off much?
Defense.
What happened, Ron, was on the pump fake, I think they held Kevin Williams, number five, the defensive back, because the pump fake, and then both receivers ran like a hitch and then took off, and I believe that they called a holding.
So the penalty is declined. Touchdown, Miami, 34-3 with Pruitt.
And I think you'll see the end of Ross Perot tonight. I think he'll head to the bench.
Good, and one more look at the touchdown.
Just a nice pump fake by Gino Toretta. Here we pick up the pump fake, and then he just lost the ball to Lamar Thomas. Aaron Beasley on coverage. Watch Lamar Thomas get up and pose. I guess that's the thing in college football now.
You know what he's doing? That's the Heisman pose, but he's pointing back at Toretta, saying, I'm passing it on to you.
It's nice to have a press agent on the field.
Toretta, 28-40 now, 363 yards and three touchdowns. And Adrian Karsten, what do you have for us?
Very happy Hurricane sidelines here, Ron. Back with my man, Rusty Medeiros. Rusty has said at the top of our game that a lot of people are mimicked the Miami offense and Miami defense, including the Washington Huskies. What do you think is the criteria now as you guys bounce back and forth between number one and number two? What is the criteria for judging the number one team in the nation?
Well, you've got to look at the overall team and what they've accomplished. This team has been through a lot, and everyone knows that we went through a hurricane. We've had some serious problems and setbacks, and we've overcome a lot. And we lost the camera. And I feel that this team, all we have to do is just keep winning, and the voters will understand that.
May have lost the camera, but certainly didn't lose the game. Ron.
Okay, Adrian telling me knows too much about television. This kick will go way out of the base of the end zone. In fact, it goes through the upright.
You know, I don't know if we're going to go back to Avery. Maybe we're going to go back to it. But I believe Rusty Medeiros was the heart and soul of that defensive football team for Miami. And that shows when you lose a player like him. And, Adrian, I'd like to know, I hope that he's going to come back and play for a couple years yet in college football.
The interesting thing about him, he asked, he wanted to transfer, didn't he, after...
I'm hoping he stays and plays here.
I'll ask him. What is the situation with the NCAA? Coach Godfrey knows that you potentially have another year of eligibility left. What do they tell you?
Well, right now we're trying to get an extra year for me, and it's going through the NCAA right now, and we should find out soon.
What do you think your situation would be even if you didn't get another year?
Well, I've got another year, and I feel I'll be 100% next year, and I'm looking forward to it. My knee is doing great. I couldn't be any better. Dr. Ruby did a heck of a job, and I'm just positive, and I think I'll be more than 100% next year, maybe even stronger.
Hang in there, man. Thanks for taking the time.
Thanks.
Adrian, the point that I was going to make, as you look at Patrick, when Jimmy Johnson announced that he was going to the Dallas Cowboys, Rusty, if memory serves me correctly, wanted to transfer. He wanted to go to another school, and they talked him into staying here.
He'd have to go, if he would have transferred, he'd have to buy his rings somewhere else because he's earned them here for the Hurricanes.
That pass to John Jones over the middle, complete at the 35. Marley again on the hit. And what he's got right there, as you look at the tombstone, that could be tombstone number 50. 50 straight wins at home with the Hurricanes, and they're going to get it tonight with only 6:20 left in this one. Don Nealon's ball club you have to say, and he wouldn't make excuses, but you have to say, a lot of injuries did not help his cause tonight. Jake Kelcher back at home, right side of his offensive line, brand new people because of injuries. As you look at Jones, unable to hold on. And Miami's the type of ball club that you got to be 100% and get 100% from your club just to stay in the contest.
What they've accomplished here at Miami with this streak in national championships in our day and age, to me, having coached football is phenomenal. And they just seem to keep getting better. The coaches told me their last year recruiting class may be their best.
Right over the middle, has it complete to Hill. And Hill will go across midfield and to the 45. Bass defensively, but it's a gain of 20.
The gain is 20.
West Virginia does a great job of recruiting in the state of Florida. And I'm sure the 15 or so players that returned here tonight, Puppy Wright, who's a solid football player and really wanted to play well for the home folks.
There under that one, but it's going to be too far out of bounds. Jones, the intended receiver. Well, we got an interesting schedule coming up next week. On Thursday night, we will be in Manhattan, Kansas, as Iowa State comes to town to take on Kansas State. And then be sure to join Mike Adrian and myself next Saturday night for a huge one up in the Big 8, 18th-ranked Kansas, traveling to Lincoln to take on the number 8-ranked Nebraska Cornhuskers in a game that could very well decide that league. 7:30 next Saturday night on that one. And in case you missed it, a huge win by Nebraska today. Stutzville in the quarterback draw. He'll take it to the 38.
Did you just see there is the update, ESPN, where Lennox Lewis knocked out Razor Ruddy tonight, which has to be an upset in boxing.
A lot of things happen on Halloween, Mike. About to go under 5 minutes left in this one. First down at the 37-yard line, and again a headgear goes flying. Damon Bethel defensively. Let's take a look at who's number one as far as statistical comparison. Scoring defense, Miami 4, Washington 2. Scoring offense, 27 and 28, very close. Strength of schedule, there is quite a discrepancy there.
I question that. I'm going to put up a disclaimer on that strength of schedule.
Quick pass goes to Garrett Ford. Bass will knock him out of bounds. And let's look at some more comparisons between Washington and Miami. Against ranked teams, 3 and 2. Ranked opponents left. Miami has 1, and Washington still has 2. And against Arizona, well, Miami won it 8-7. And on the 7th, those are the only common opponents. Or that is the only common opponent that they have. Washington faces him coming up on November the 7th. It's Freeman with the carry to around the 25. 4 minutes and 20 seconds and counting. Bethel and Smith combining on the tackle.
If I was to rank the top five in the country right now, I'd rank Miami number one, Washington number two, Alabama number three. I feel like they should have been three. Even though Michigan had a close game, they still think Alabama should have been third. Fourth A&M, and then a tie for fifth between Michigan and Florida State.
That's still pass, and still wrestling with Gallimore as he pushes him out of bounds at the 18th. And you know, I disagree with the position on top.
That, huh?
Well, Washington still has not done anything, as far as I'm concerned, to lose the number one spot. In fact, I think they have played a tougher schedule. So, you know, this is a big win against an impressive team tonight by Dennis's crew, but Washington had a very impressive win today as well. So And I still think the Pac-10 is heads and shoulders above other conferences this year.
I think Miami, the fact of what they accomplished beating Florida State and going back-to-back at Penn State, beat Penn State up in Happy Valley, and beating the Arizona football team.
Jet with the touchdown pass.
When you talk about West Virginia, remember, never say die. This football team just refuses to quit. James Jett has been involved in the pass offense tonight. He had 9 catches going into this game for 189 yards and 2 touchdowns. He has been the primary target tonight of Darren Studstill.
Vanderjagt to attempt the extra point to try to cut it to a 25-point ball game. It looks like West Virginia did not have enough people on the field. So a timeout is called by the Mountaineers.
And I'll tell you another team that when we talk about Alabama, I'm telling you one thing. I've seen them. They are a solid, solid football team.
Well, be sure to join us next Saturday night, and this is the big one we were talking about in the Big 8 Conference. The Kansas Jayhawks, they continue to roll along. They'll travel up to Lincoln, Nebraska to take on the Cornhuskers in a game that just could decide that league championship. 7:30 on ESPN as you look at the national scoring offense leaders, Nebraska 2 and Kansas 3.
Tom Osborne and staff won't have too much time to enjoy the big win over Colorado.
Vanderjagt with the kick, and he's perfect with it. Well, let's take one more look at the touchdown as we go to break. There is a flag down.
Offside on the defense. Point's good. Penalized on the kickoff.
Penalty coming on the kickoff. 3:40 left in the ballgame, and our new score, Miami 35, West Virginia 10, as Jett puts it in for the first touchdown for the Mountaineers.
In Orlando.
Well, welcome back, and get ready for the onside kick. 35 to 10 with 3:40 left to play, and the good hands team waits for Miami, and Mark Johnson prepares to put it into the dirt. On the ground, and it is going to be taken by Miami. By Harris, who made the recovery.
Taken by Garrett Harris. First and 10 at midfield.
Yeah, we're going to get Frank Costa in at quarterback.
Frank is a sophomore out of Philadelphia. Now, you talk about within an area where a bunch of good ones have come out. Costa's part of that group within 35-mile radius of Philadelphia. Glenn Foley at Boston College, John Sacker from Penn State, and, of course, Frank Costa in that group, and Matt Blunden, along with Tony Sacker in that same radius, Mike.
It's good high school football in that area. They have produced an outstanding high school quarterback.
Ferguson with the carry, and a late flag comes in from the near sideline.
Looks like face mask.
Gain is 2.
Face mask on the defense.
Mike, I just want to say, well, we got a second this past week. Football lost a friend, Wilson Whitley, who was only 37 years of age, died of a heart attack in the state of Georgia. He played at the University of Houston under Bill Yeoman. He won the Lombardi Award Trophy. And he just, besides being a football player, he was a man of character, and 37 years was far too short to have such an outstanding young man. And we send our expressions of grief to his family and to his friends. He was an outstanding young man. Just as the ball is handed off, it's Steve Perkins who steps up to make the hit.
Ron, you talk about that. Another death this week was Tom Cahill, the former Army coach, died this past week, too. Was a fine college football coach for Army, and he will be missed.
Under 3 minutes to play in this one. Miami 35 and West Virginia 10.
Adrian must have went up the stands.
Lamar Thomas took off his shoulder pads some time ago. He knew his night was over. Gonna enjoy this one from the sideline. Ferguson again. He gets tagged pretty good by West Richardson. You could hear him screaming ball, and there was a turnover and recovered by West Virginia. Now, here is something, although we only have 2:25 left in the game, it is totally out of hand. Something that Miami would like to keep intact. They have given up the ball. This is 9 times this year. They have not given up a touchdown or a field goal following a turnover, and that's something that's very important to this defense.
Well, when you look, when you say that, Ron, your point is well taken, because I see Michael Barrow on the field. I see Darren Smith on the field. So they want to keep this intact.
Go deep, and he's got Jet there. Has the completion inside the 30-yard line. Marcus Carey there on the cover, but it's good for 25 yards.
If you're going to play West Virginia in the last 3 football games, maybe we'll take a look at their schedule, upcoming schedule. You're going to have to defend James Jet and Darren Studstill, because they have found that passing game tonight in this game with Miami.
Go with the running play. Jones inside the 10-yard line, and he's down to the 9. And on the near side of the field, a couple of people saying we want to go in the ball game. And Lopez and Warren Sapp quickly strap up and come in at defensive tackle. They're going to have to hurry to get off the field. They don't realize the play is about to be run, and they did not get off the field, and a flag is thrown. Pass caught for the touchdown by Ed Hill.
Now, Ron, this won't have any effect on this play, but I think this is a terrible call by this official now. I mean, that's a call. I mean, I know that they're 4 yards from the sideline. He throws this flag.
Illegal substitution on the defense. On the defense. On the defense.
That's not the way you want to end the game if you're Dennis Erickson. Is a positive for Don Nayland on the other sideline.
35-16 with 1:44 left. So Vanderjack gets an opportunity here within a couple of minutes of each other. Flag is down across the way. Now, all of a sudden, the ball game that had been pretty cleanly played gets a little sloppy here.
Not enough men on the line of scrimmage.
So they'll step this one back, and in basketball, they call it garbage time.
I think you can say the same tonight.
And for the most part, the over 50,000 here at the Orange Bowl is headed on to the Halloween party.
That man's not happy right there with that last score.
As I said, it's the first one that they've given up off a turnover this year. And that's the kind of thing, it may seem small, but it's not. It's one of those things that you build off of for a defense or for an offense, regardless of what the incentive. Extra point is good. So our new score, the Miami Hurricanes 35 and West Virginia 17. And tonight's Visa players of the game are from West Virginia, running back Adrian Morrell, 19 carries, 76 yards. And from Miami, Gino Toretta, 28 of 40, 363, and he had 3 touchdown passes. And in part of their continuing effort to further the development of amateur athletics, Visa is proud to donate $1,000 to each of these universities, $1,000 to the U.S. Olympic team on behalf of these athletes. .144 left to play.
A
tonight, Lincoln, Nebraska. Kansas and the Cornhuskers out of Nebraska. Mike, you're right. The Cornhuskers don't get a long time to enjoy that one. But they know the task at hand, and the conference is awfully important to them after they drop that game up in Seattle to Washington. Onside kick, here it goes. And that one touched last by West Virginia and goes out of bounds.
The onside kick is out of bounds.
Not possession, but only touched by West Virginia. Adrian Morrell, our player of the game for West Virginia. Coming up next, the Residence Inn College Scoreboard Show.
There's a competitor in Don Nalen, down by 18 points, still trying to figure ways to get the football and get points in the end zone. He's a competitor.
Competitor, and he's also a gentleman. Always has been, in victory or in defeat. Ball is on the ground. Costa scrambling for it. West Virginia says they have recovered and the officials agree. Now Dennis Erickson really is not going to be happy about this. That is Steve Perkins who makes the recovery, but a very sloppy finish by Miami tonight.
He's just not receiving the snap from the center. Watch the ball come up. It hits above his hands and he never really gets the football in his hands.
And if you wondered what all the traffic was, that was a counter tray, it appeared, that they were about to run. And those big linemen trying to get out in front of the play, and he couldn't get back to it. Touchdown complete over the middle to Al Johnson. And the tight end will take it down to the 21-yard line.
Hey, Darren Studstone, these last three drives, and I know it's late in the game and Miami has a big lead, but I'm telling you, he's right on the money with this passing game. He's pretty impressive. They better start taping back up again.
Crine also getting taped up. That's Patrick. You see Crine as a timeout has been called, and let's take a break with 1:26 left in the ballgame, 35-17 Miami. Our score with 1:26 left in the ballgame. A couple of substitutes, Patrick and Prime back in the ballgame for the Hurricane. Substitute delivers the pass. Whoa, does he get whacked out of bounds? It was Marley.
He's quickly becoming a name here on this defense as a hitter.
5'8", 200 pounds. Far sideline, throws it complete, and Hill will step out of bounds, and he will step out at the 7-yard line. Siegel was there defensively.
Ron, a lot of the first teamers are in on defense, but you can't sit on the sideline for 8-9 minutes and not have it affect you. This isn't going to go a long way in determining who wins this game, but this is kind of a challenge right now to the West Virginia offense and the Miami first team defense. In there.
Mike, if they score, could that damage your number one standard? Rolls it, throws the pass, in and out of the hands of James Jett. He was having to keep an eye on the sideline. What do you think?
I don't think so, because I don't go for the big scores and building that up. And I think the reason Dennis Erickson brought back his first team is because he didn't want to finish the game on a negative. I mean, this team lost its sharpness, and you can't afford to lose that in future ball games. And I think he's saying to his defensive team, hey, go back up there and back out there and get control of this thing. We've lost control of it.
Pressure from the outside to the corner. Touchdown, Ed Hill.
That further deflates you if you're Miami.
A flag is down back at the 13-yard line.
Late hit on the defense. Touchdown, penalized on the kickoff.
Pouring salt in the wound here as far as upsetting Miami.
Well, I tried, as we watched the game progress, you could just see this West Virginia team didn't have any quit in its eyes. They just kept playing hard. The pass to Ed Hill, perfectly thrown football. Terrace Harris, the starting safety, in coverage, whipped by Ed Hill. Dave, 35-23, it looks like they're going to go for two. Ball will be on the 1.5-yard line, so if they can get that, now you're down to 10. You're still a couple onside kicks away from going home yet.
With 61 seconds left on the clock. And the offense has the opportunity of the placement of the ball, so it's on the left hash mark. Pressure from the outside. Complete, looking for Jet. It was Marley again coming across with the pressure.
Rohan Marley is an awesome football player. He makes things happen.
So 61 seconds left in the ball game. 35-23. The Miami Hurricanes leading by 12.
You can count on one thing. Dennis Erickson's going to have his receivers and DBs on this onside kick team.
Well, this is what has happened. The ball game was totally put away. It was 35-3. Jet, an 18-yard touchdown pass from Studstill, made it 35-10. Then Hill, a 10-yard pass from Studstill, 35-17. And at 1:01 left to play in the game, Hill, the 7-yard TD pass from Studstill. The two-point conversion is no good, and that's how we stand at 35-23. But 20 unanswered points by the Mountaineers here in this fourth quarter. With the onside kick, bounces off a Miami player. That's Mountaineer football.
Boy, if you just can, Dennis Erickson right there, you can read frustration all over the face of the head coach of the Miami Hurricanes. He is a frustrated football coach right now.
Kwame Smith made the recovery.
There's the face of an excited quarterback that has made some things happen here in the fourth quarter.
Sack way back at the 22-yard line. Kevin Patrick, the first man through, and in Warren Sapp as well.
Well, they're trying to put an end to this football game with 43 seconds to go on the clock with a good pass rush.
You know,
West Virginia's got to hurry here.
Flag goes down as the pass incomplete, and another flag upfield at the 34.
Holding. On the offense.
You can see Garrett Ford saying, no, I don't believe so.
Holding on the offense. Holding on the defense. Offset, replay, second down.
Dennis is talking to himself there about this last quarter.
Running play, and Jones gets outside and then out of bounds as he crosses the 40. Siegler holding on to him, and we still have 15 seconds left.
At the 42, game to 17.
So with that 17-yard pickup, Don Nealon and his staff continuing to coach in the far sideline, hoping that the Mountaineers can get one more. Pass overthrown and incomplete. Jet is the man he wanted. We have 8 ticks left.
You know, Toretta seems like an eternity since we watched him on the field. He's been out for a while.
Studs still 22 of 40, 265 yards, 3 touchdowns, and 2 interceptions.
West Virginia's going to take a timeout. Not to the happiness of a lot of the fans that have remained here.
So we're going to take it with them. Timeout on the field. 8 seconds left to play. 8 seconds from Halloween.
WIOD, 6:10 a.m.
35-23. West Virginia on fourth down with one last chance. 8 ticks left on the clock. Tackle come out of his stance too quickly.
Dead ball.
Dead ball.
False start. False start. On the offense.
On the offense.
Don Nayland's thoughts are now in his final 3 games. I still think this team has a chance for a bowl game. Ron, I think you'll see them in a bowl game. I think they can win their final 3 ball games.
Puts it up on top, looking for Hill. Tip, and it is caught by Hill at the 21-yard line as the clock runs out. No flags, and this one is over. Once again, the final score, Miami 35, West Virginia 23. So stay tuned for the Residence Inn College Football School Board, which follows next. For Mike Godfrey, Adrian Karsten, I'm Ron Franklin. Good night from Miami, Florida. Now let's go to Chris Fowler at our school board studios.